From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastofwar.com. It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastofwar.com.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Weekender. We've made it back from Salute.
We're alive.
None of us got lost. None of us died of drinking too much.
None of us got lost. I lost you and Warren on the Saturday night.
Yes, but then I found him. and we got lost together.
Well, you were together, so you weren't lost.
And stuck on the flipping night bus from the centre of London all the way back to the hotel for an hour and a half.
A three-hour tour.
It was glorious. If you ever meet one of our backstagers who was there, ask them to tell you the glorious adventures of Warren Stagdo.
It wasn't glorious, it was annoying.
Okay, so it was inglorious.
Anyway, before we get stuck into the show, you can maybe hear that my voice is completely shot. That, we did that on the way back because we took a detour on our way to the boat to go to Blackpool Pleasure Beach, which has just destroyed me because this fool here put me on every scary ride imaginable. Yeah. And I squealed and shouted and squealed and roared and ejected volume from my mouth.
For anyone that knows Blackpool, I took Lloyd on the Infusion. Now, this is a roller coaster which actually has your legs dangling and does corkscrews and barrel rolls and flips, and it's glorious and it's wonderful. And I was just going, hey, all the way around. Whereas he was going, ah!
No, whereas I was going, do, 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 do.
Yeah, you got your ears boxed in.
I'm having my ears battered. I did get my own back though, because I put Justin on all the old roller coasters.
Oh, yeah.
The ones made of wood.
That are 200 years old.
And I sit in the carriage beside him, and I'm like, oh, Justin, look at that bit there. Woodworm's definitely eating that bit. Look at that bolt over there.
That doesn't look safe. Yeah.
This is the thing, though. If I'm on a modern roller coaster, it's a modern engineering marvel. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. If I'm on a 200-year-old piece of crap that's ready to fall apart, I'm nervous.
They are scary.
But you know, if there's going to be a catastrophe, it's either going to be a modern catastrophe or an older catastrophe.
Well, you see, there was one
this really isn't going to matter.
There was one I went on with Warren called the Mouse. Mm-hmm. Now, some of the old roller coasters, you at least get the click down bar.
Right.
Click down bar. So click, 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 down.
He's grand. He's talking about my favorite and least favorite at the same time.
It's called the Mouse. This thing doesn't have a bar, nothing like that. The car takes two people in tandem, one in front of the other, so Warren was in behind me. Nothing else except for a seatbelt holding your ass into this damn thing. It is scary because it does 90 degree turns in about, 2 foot? So it's just like...
Yeah, it's neck-breaker. It doesn't go particularly fast. It kind of just does this and goes around the corner.
Yeah, it's a neck-breaker. You get whiplash from this thing.
But it's not the whiplash. It's the fact the carriage does this. Every time it gets to a corner, it goes like that. You're like, oh my God!
You're going to dump out.
Oh yeah.
But then you have the low parts where it looks as if it's going to clip the top of your head off.
Yes.
That scares the hell out of me.
I was in the carriage with Lance. Mm-hmm. He'll be sitting in the next room probably watching us at the minute.
Yeah.
But he literally had to go like this.
Lance is quite the big dude.
There's the slope that you go up to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
It went onto this low pass and he literally had to do this.
I was hyperventilating by the end of that thing. Just being like, oh God, let me off.
It's great.
It sounds great.
Give me a modern engineering marvel that's going to chuck me all around the place. I'm fine with that.
Anyway, it has had a toll on my voice, so...
Yeah.
If you hear a croaky version of Lloyd, it's rather sexy.
It's his working number.
That's what's happened. Right, Justin, let's kick off the show by talking about some competition winners. And we've got loads of competition winners to talk about.
Yeah.
And that's not even the Salute competition winners.
No.
This
is ones from last week. So I'll take care of this because I'm going to be fair to Lloyd. I'm going to give him a rest.
The week before last week.
Yeah. Okay, so first up, we have a prize from Mythos. Actually, five prizes from Mythos. So you know the Sea Queen miniature that you love?
I do.
We have five of those to give away, and we've picked five winners. So our first winner, Marine 101. Congratulations, buddy.
Woo-hoo.
Second winner, Maytresix. Congratulations. We then have Minigiant, Horus 500, and Yahatch 28, I think it is, because it's J-A Hatch 28, okay? So it's Yahatch 28 or Yahatch 28. I'm not sure how you pronounce it. So that's our first set of winners. Our next set of winners is from the Flames of War Pacific Gung Ho Banzai signed books that we were getting to give away on one of our blogs.
Yep.
So we have seven winners for this. So get ready to hear your name and do the jammy dance as Lloyd would love you to do. Jammy dance?
Oh.
Okay, first winner. Anders B80. Next, Zachman 22, Smitty 14, Lordtothe, Ranger, Ishivia, Ishivia. If that's your name, congratulations.
Pay attention.
And lastly, Basilbrush.
We can put all these names in the post.
They'll
below.
Be in the post.
Yes.
But I wouldn't miss the opportunity of having Justin read them all out.
Me mangling some person's name. Apologies.
And slaughtering them. Right. That's a lot of prizes.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of prizes. They're up for grabs from Sloot as well.
A lot is an understatement.
We're not going to announce any winners this week. But if you haven't been checking out the Sloot Live blog, you're missing out. Because there's no less than 17 prizes up for grabs.
And they're big prizes.
Yeah, everybody went nuts at it.
Get your butt in there. Get commenting on each individual video for your chance to win the prizes mentioned in the video.
Right, quick question.
We've over 5,000 flipping comments in there.
Quick question for each of you then. Four prizes from Sloot. Don, what's your favorite so far?
Oh, you know what? I'm going to have to go with the foreground table. It's like, it's a whole table.
The table? Yeah.
Yes,
nice.
Whole table. You can't not be excited about that.
Lloyd, what about you? Is it going to be the Halo Minis, the exclusives?
The Halo Minis are nice.
Yeah.
But it has to be the foreground table.
I know, right? It's a table.
All right.
It's a table's worth.
All right. Do I know what? It's unanimous, the foreground table, because the guys at Foreground are giving away three prizes, one of which is a full foreground, massive monster prize of a thing. It's
Ben.
The gothic table.
Mm. You forgot that.
Oh, yeah, Dan. Sorry, I forgot about you, buddy.
What do you think?
Oh, I definitely think that we should all be voting to get that, well, entering to try and get that Viking starter set so you can all get playing Saga and I can play more of you. That's fantastic.
There you go.
Ben doesn't care about tables, he just wants opponents.
Yeah, more opponents to die.
I must crush you all.
Yeah, with my Viking horde.
Actually, he plays Anglo-Danes the get.
Yeah, with my Anglo-Danes horde.
He plays the Vikings and I might go North Gales.
Yeah, with my North Gales horde.
Blank face of Lloyd.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Also, on the prize front, a couple of weeks ago, we had the Infinity M3
Human Sphere.
Sphere Week.
Yeah.
Yes.
We still have a couple of prizes that are up for claiming.
Yeah, yeah.
If you haven't watched last week's week, well, not last week's weekender, but the
week
before. 2 weeks
ago's weekender.
You're a fool!
Catch up!
You're a fool! Yeah. You're missing out on knowing whether you've won something. Go and watch the show, and if you have, claim it! Claim your prize, for goodness sakes!
For anyone that doesn't realize it, I actually annotated that video, so there's an annotation through that segment where we're talking about the prizes, where you can actually just go click, and it takes you straight through to our prize claim.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Awesome stuff. Right, Ben, before I jump into the news, you want to talk about an article that's just appeared on the website, World of Darkness Premier.
Yeah, so this was something by Chris Handley of Darker Days Radio. He collaborated with Sam on this one for an article towards the end of last week. It was on Thursday. And this is a fantastic one, sort of getting you sort of ready, a primer almost for the World of Darkness role-playing game. Now, there's a lot of people, we've been talking about this ourselves about role-playing games and stuff like that, but we've all gone down the fantasy and sci-fi routes and stuff. The World of Darkness is something entirely different, which actually gets you playing as the monsters. So like the werewolves, vampires, changelings, demons, and all that sort of thing. And if that sort of bites you and says, fantastic, this sounds great, you should go and check out that article because it's a really, really good intro to the whole world of it. So go and read that one. Yeah.
And Chris runs his own podcast, I believe.
Yes, he does. Yeah, it's Darker Day. So you can go and listen to those guys about all sorts of things to do with the World of Darkness and extra things as well. So they talk about some of the old stuff for the fantasy ranges and things from Old Hammer and things like that as well. So yeah.
Awesome cool. Stuff. Right, I'm going to move us in. I'm going to get stuck in.
Okay.
To the news, if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm.
Ben, what's first up on the news, mate?
Yeah, so the first thing that we're going to be looking at today is some news about Age of Sigmar. And this is that the Uruks, the old orcs, are coming back with a new look. And they are very shiny indeed. Yes.
So this
Hello.
this is images that came out. Mm-hmm. By the time we've put this show out, DW should have these on their website, I believe.
Yes, they will be up for pre-order on the web store as you're viewing this episode right now. Yes. So, yeah.
So, Ben, what do you think? I'm really taken with them myself.
I really like these, actually. I think one of the things with the orcs is that they've always felt a little bit sort of the the comic relief almost of the Warhammer and Warhammer 40k world. So this is their opportunity to do something a little bit different and look a bit sort of more badass and brutal and dangerous looking. And I think these models look really, really cool. They've sort of gone for a very much more sort of World of Warcraft style orc. So they're bigger, tougher, stand a lot taller than a normal human compared to the orcs from the old Warhammer, which stood sort of around the same size. And I actually really like these. Oh, the paint scheme is something to be desired, in my opinion. But I think with the right paint scheme, these will look really good.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm really digging it. Dawn, I can hear you.
I like this guy.
To get stuck in. Let's go back to what Dawn's liking.
I'm not sure about these, I'm going to say.
Are you really?
I'm liking this too. Dawn.
Yeah.
What's appealing?
Oh, come on. Look at what he's riding there.
The armor's too complete. It looks too well forged to be orcish.
Well, let's forget him for a second. Look, he's on like a big dragon thing.
Right?
Oh, no, the dragon thing is fantastic. I like it. I love the fact that it's got plates and stuff nailed and strapped onto it. But the orc himself, or the Uruk himself.
The Uruk.
I'm not quite so much a fan of. I like the old ramshackle look of orcs where it's just, you know, I've got a rusty bit of metal, I'm going to beat that into an axe, a sword, armor plate, that'll do.
I don't know, let's go back up and have a look at a couple of the others. I'm really digging it, Ben, I'm with you on this.
Mm-hmm. Well, the shaman's quite nice.
I was going to say, I get what you're saying, Justin, but I like the looks of these guys a lot more than where we started with the Age of Sigmar. This feels more high fantasy to me, if I was going to get in and play.
You see, it's given the orcs more of a noble savage feel to them than what I always envisage them as just pure, nasty, heavy metal savages that want to rip your head off.
I don't know where you're getting noble.
Noble savage.
Scroll on up. Let's see the next
It's one. More, like you say, World of
right.
Warcraft.
Stop here. Look right. how badass that is.
Right?
I really like it. I think I like it because I'm surprised by it.
Yes. Mm.
If someone said, have you seen the Age of Sigmar orcs? Or orcs.
Right.
I probably wouldn't have bothered to bat an eyelid and think, I will see them. And then you see this and you go, oh my goodness, that is so much more out there compared to what I thought they were going to be like.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, I like the old school orcs. I like the feel of just raw tribal, you know, lifestyle instead of this. You know, I imagine this orc actually has a city that he lives in. Dress, stone, and all the works. He's not living in a rawhide tent.
Well, it's interesting, actually, because from what we know a little bit about the sort of the background of these guys, these are a particular sect of orcs. So these are a tribe in themselves called the Iron Jaws, as you can see by the sort of black iron jaws that they have around their chin area and stuff like that. So these guys are a particular set of orcs, but you can still play the normal ones that you've known from Warhammer and things like that. They'll all have different names and stuff, obviously, when the book comes out. But yeah, you can still go for the ramshackle orc that you like as well, Justin.
I'm thinking no. I really like these.
This is for you then, like.
So we'll get to know more about this in the Destruction book and the Iron Jaws book then, Ben.
Yes, yeah, these books are coming out. Well, they'll be up for pre-order this weekend as well. I'm sure there'll be more information about these in the next coming days and stuff like that. So yeah.
Cool.
Awesome. Awesome stuff. Right, staying on the GW front. There's another product coming out of GW that's creating some waves.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not really surprised because quite a few people have looked at it and thought, oh, big and epic and actually quite good value for money.
Right.
Some people are commenting. Yeah. Let's have a look at the Imperial Knights Renegade box set.
Okay,
Ben, I'm going to come to you first on this. What can you tell us about it?
Yeah, so this is a box set that contains two Imperial Knights. You have one of them that is a loyalist and one of them that is a renegade, the chaotic one. And the whole deal with this box is that you get two knights that are going to be duking out with a set of rules that come in the box. So it's a it's almost like a little mini game encased in its own little box. You also get some terrain and dice and things like that. But it's basically a really cool way, in their mind, I guess, for you to have two knights to just fight it out on the tabletop if you really like these models. So, yeah.
Which is cool. Can we go back up to the main pictures?
Yeah.
What I'm liking about it is I kind of like the idea of the mini game rather than it just being here we're selling some minis at a cheaper price or something.
Yeah.
Here we've bundled them together and we've made some effort around it as well.
Well, you see, who doesn't like a good classic monster fight? You know, you watch old Japanese Godzilla movies and it's just two big nasty monsters going at each other. That's the feeling I'm getting from this. What do you think, Lloyd?
Yeah, absolutely. We all like to see nasty monsters going at each other.
It's got that old school monster feel to it.
Okay.
One of the interesting things with this actually is that I think in an old white dwarf that was sort of, well, an old White Dwarf that was a new White Dwarf, if you know what I mean. But in one of those, they had a little bit of a mini game where you played as Imperial Knights like this. And I think they've taken that idea and refined it a little bit so that it's more palatable to people to play. And obviously, you're not going to be able to get your hands on that old White Dwarf, but you can obviously get your hands on Renegade and play it this way. So
Yeah, I'm liking it a lot. Mm-hmm. I like the fact you get terrain with it, too. Mm. I just like that. I just like the effort, effort of going, let's not just knock the price off an Imperial Knight, or let's not just bundle two together and give a discount. Let's put them together. Let's make a box. Let's give them some terrain. Let's give them some rules. I just like the overall packaging. It's tickling me with the whole Games Workshop and the board game sort of things. Mm-hmm. I know this isn't a board game, but I'm liking these packages that they're coming
this
up with.
This might be a good access point for somebody. You're not already in the game, you know, and especially since it's, in their terms, a little bit more reasonable because you're getting, you know, a whole set, you know, in one price, it might be a good starting point for somebody if they already think the models look cool. Mm. See if you're really going to play
definitely.
With it.
Yeah. Well, the other thing they're doing is they've also got a little mini PDF that you can go and have a look at as well as this to actually show you how to do the damage on the Chaos Knight's face. You know, so it's nice to see those little things starting to creep back in with GW.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're dropping in a couple of really nice sort of hobby bits and pieces. Yeah, it's really cool.
And then I briefly mentioned cost. It's £120 for the set.
Yep.
Normally they're £85 each, these models.
A significant saving.
So it is pretty significant. So for £120, you're getting the two models.
Uh-huh.
You're getting some terrain.
Terrain. Yep.
You're getting two dice. That's really important. Two dice.
Not one, but two.
Even the Cities of Death stuff, some of the stuff you can pick up can be reasonably pricey at times, depending on how much you're getting.
Yeah,
you
know, that's
so
a good point.
So it's nice
to
see that in there as well.
We shouldn't undervalue that.
Yeah,
no.
That's a good point. I did see someone comment on the website they've picked this up for £90 delivered.
Not bad.
I don't know where they got it for £90 delivered, but I'm a guy going,
look around, look around.
Yeah. You've got deals out there if you can find them.
I'm not sure if it tickles me from a packaging point of view. I'm probably never going to go buy one of these because I don't know what I'd ever do with a model this size. Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I could see myself and John just going, you know what, I'm bored. We've got maybe an hour to kill. Let's break out the knights and have a bit of a scrap.
Ben. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Would this something like this appeal to you if you were passing by?
I'd be totally happy to play it if someone else picked it up, but I don't think I'd pick it up myself. No.
Mm. Well, I don't know. For me, I would definitely have a closer look at this. If you like your 40k, if you're maybe considering getting into the Knights, because it is a really nice army and it is one that's a really low model count, even if it's really big models. You know, and you can if you're a painter, you can really go to town on these because. We've seen some beautiful paint jobs done for the knights in the past, haven't we?
I suppose it is a very good springboard into building a knight's army.
Yeah.
For example, I was looking at the barrage of releases coming out of Privateer Press the other week.
Yeah.
And I was looking at all the box sets going, oh, I really want to just get some of those and paint them.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe...
See, here's the other thing.
If you like Games Workshop, it's going to appeal to
you.
Yeah. And if you're a modeler and painter, you could do a very nice diorama with what you're getting in this.
Yeah,
oh, that would be fantastic.
Let's see them up close again.
Yeah, sure. So here they are again. So you've got your box, you've got your terrain, and you've got your two guys.
Yeah, and the actual minis look like, I say minis, but they're more like statues.
Yeah. Well, you see, you've got your Loyalist one, which has got that real Imperial feel to it, that stalwart defender type thing.
Yeah.
And then you've got the Chaos one, which does just have that beat down, rusty, fallen to chaos look to it, which is really nice.
Okay, excellent. Right, staying with sci-fi and battles of the future, let's have a look at the Gates of Antari Skyriders and the Heavy Combat Drone.
Yeah,
Ben,
these are really
why
nice.
Are we looking at these? Because we've seen some previews and things like that. Are they out this week? Is that what the big deal is?
They came out during this week, sort of the tail end of last week, the beginning of this one. They were available at Salute and stuff like that as well. So yes, we have the Sky Raiders, which are a Freeborn unit. They're basically sort of, you could imagine them as the scouting units of the Freeborn. They fly ahead of the main force. They're armed with little guns, but they're not great at taking out things, but fantastic for securing objectives and things like that when you've got some nippy troops in there.
They're essentially running around on jet skis that fly.
Right.
Pretty much.
These look like to me.
Pretty much.
They're really cool. I like this.
I'm going to correct myself. The Sky Raiders, because I think I called them the Sky Riders. I actually like these a lot. Bring them up. Look at them, right? They're a bit like a jet ski, but go to the other picture because it emphasizes it more. Mm. I really like the way the capes and stuff, and they look like they're really just forcing them bikes to go where they want.
Yeah.
You know, really pushing down on them and stuff. I actually kind of like it. Go back up again. Yeah.
the minis have a really nice dynamism to them, where you can actually get that sense of motion and actual purpose to them.
Yeah.
You know, so it is that snapshot moment.
That's what I'm looking for. It looks like they've got weight.
Yes.
Both the bike itself and the actual person riding it, the way they're posed it.
The way they're having to kick it around in the air to get it to
move. Really like that, because a lot of bikes in games you see...
It's very much...
It's a very stationary.
Static, yeah.
You know, most bikes are like that. What do you think, Dawn?
Oh, I totally agree. Mm-hmm. I like the sense of movement a lot, and... You know, anytime you can have capes flapping in the wind like that, too.
Well, again, for your painters, it just gives you a really nice area to do some cool freehand on,
yes.
which is always, always good.
Okay, awesome stuff. Moving on, then, we have the drone as well.
Yeah, so this is the big, heavy combat drone that sort of works for the Concorde, but it will also work for the Freeborn as well. So you can paint it up in some interesting blues and things like that and drop it into there. And this is basically their version of a massive tank. Warlord aren't going to go away from any game without making something huge with a massive cannon on it. And this is basically what this one is. So it comes with, as you can see here, a plasma cannon on the top. I've no idea how that actually works in game, but there are two other versions of the cannon as well that you can attach to this and sort of mix and match it if you like to.
I like the look of this. I like the idea of actually having big, hefty vehicles in the Gates of Antares now. And the fact that the Freeborn can have it as well kind of makes sense, because they're the traders of this universe. So if there's one of these out on the black market, obviously they're going to have it. Let's be honest here.
I like that tool. I like the fact that, well, the Concorde is probably my favorite faction in Gates of Antares. So I'm kind of excited to see this coming out, because I think that rounds out just the high-techness look of them, and I like that a lot. But I like the fact that the other faction has been able to just nab that and say, oh, I'm going to have that too.
Right, right.
Well, I mean, like, I am hearing some rumors that this isn't the biggest vehicle we're going to see come out for the Gates of Antares. And I'm also hearing that this is probably going to have a transport capacity at some point. So it is going to be a multi-purpose vehicle eventually, I would say.
Cool.
Very sounds cool. Awesome.
Yeah. That's awesome stuff. Dawn.
We got to see this up close at Salute. This was one of the things. And in fact, this is one of the fabulous things that is up for prizes, you know, in the Salute coverage. So if this is something that people like the looks of, you need to make sure you comment in that Warlord section.
Yeah, definitely. I'd love to get one of these in my hands.
It was awesome. It looked beautiful on the display that they had it on. It was perched above one of the big arching areas that they had. It was awesome. It was just sitting right up there. Yeah, it looked
really cool.
It looked great.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome stuff. I want to come back to it in a second, but I'm just going to emphasize what Dawn's just been saying. Again, visit the Salute Live blog. 17 prizes up for grabs.
That was one of them.
From many, many different companies. Yeah. So there's something in there you're going to want to get your hands on.
Now, I'm liking this idea of it being a transport as well.
Well, you see, it's one of those major things. It's fleshing out the actual warfare style for Gates of Antares. Because up until now, it's been sort of, okay, I've units of men and weapons teams. You've units of men and weapons team. Now we're seeing the armor rollouts. We're seeing a new stage of warfare. Adding in your troop transports, that's going to really change up the dynamics of how the game's going to play, because you're going to be moving units from place to place to place to take objectives.
Yeah, this is the point where it stops feeling sort of skirmishy.
Yes.
It starts feeling full-on
sci-fi
war game. I'm going to destroy you
with my
drone!
You and me have been looking for a game. If you want, I'm quite happy to hook the Freeborn.
I'm quite happy to take the Concorde.
If you want to give it a go, I'm happy to join you in it.
Right.
All right,
you can go Freeborn, I'll go Concorde.
That's fine.
Okay, if we get a drone, we can break it in half.
What we do is, we put a line right down the middle.
This is
my half of the drone, this is your half of the drone. I paint one my way, you paint one your way.
I don't know, so essentially it's going to spin around in circles, you know, through your gameplay.
Oh my god, that's what we do. Roll a dice to see who has control of it each turn.
There you go.
So what? I just now have a cartoon image of you and me inside the bloody drone. Both trying to yank on the bloody controls.
Yes, Justin. Both of us trying to yank it together.
Do that again.
Yank the controls, Justin. You just missed that. Anyway, Ben, do you want a last word on that before I move us on?
Yeah, I think it looks really cool. I would say that you guys are going for Freeborn and Concorde. I'd have to go for the Isaurians. We looked at them a little while back on one of the older Weekenders. Mm-hmm. So if you want to check out those guys, go and have a look at one of them.
Yeah, we actually have a bit of a project blog where John, I think, painted them up, as well as the Boromites.
Right, cool.
Yeah.
If I remember correctly. So you could go and check that out as well on
beastwar.com. Fantastic, yeah.
Right, awesome stuff. I'm going to move us on and get into we have an interview to come up that Justin and yourself and Warren managed to get talking to William Schick, isn't it?
Yes, from Privateer Press, because Mark III is coming out, and I can't wait. Everything is looking fantastic for this game, and I am really, really excited about it. But I want to jump straight into the interview, because I'm sure everyone out there is just waiting and waiting and waiting to hear what's going on. So we'll see you after some hubs.
Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastofwar.com. Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game.
Hi guys, and it's time for some Warmachine Hordes news. We're joined by Will Schick from Privateer Press. Will, welcome to Beast of War.
Hey guys, how you doing?
Okay, so Will, biggest release of the year on its way, June 29th, 2016.
Oh, I can't wait for this.
This is going to be awesome. So,
I agree.
Will, can you tell us a bit about it? So, we've heard it was called Project Egg Roll. How long ago did it start? And what was the kind of the key motivations that you guys had in your minds when you were taking another look at the whole Warmachine Hordes system?
Sure. So, well, one, I wish it was Project Egg Roll. It was just literally Egg Roll. Like, it wasn't even fancy. So hang on.
Whenever you were going to events and stuff, did you just have fans going, what the hell's with the Privateer crew? They're all eating Chinese food a lot recently.
Yeah.
We've been working on Egg Roll or the new editions for quite some time. And I mean, the thing was, is like every time you'd hear the word Egg Roll, you'd be like, what, who said what? And you'd have to like check to make sure they weren't talking about it or anything. But it became one of those things where eventually it was such a constant thing that we were like, you know what we should do is it lock and load. And we're not doing this, but we were like, at lock and load, wouldn't it be great if we just like came out with like platters of egg rolls, you know? And we wouldn't tell anybody why, right? We would never mention the code name, and we just have egg rolls, and people are like, what's with all the egg rolls? And we'd be like, oh, you know.
I mean really the
process, obviously, it began, you know, about in reality began about 4 years ago, where we started really looking at stuff. And this was after the advent of the huge bases. We knew that those things were really going to radically alter the play environments in ways that, despite all of our testing and external testing and stuff with them, that we really wouldn't be able to foresee until, you know, a couple years down the road. So we kind of knew going into it that there was likely a rebalancing that would need to happen. And obviously, with any game, in order to keep it, you know, living and fresh and alive, at some point you have to come in and you kind of have to, like, I use the term bonsai tree a lot recently in talking about this stuff, but if you imagine like a bonsai tree, the new growth eventually overwhelms kind of the original vision that you have for the form and the shape of that tree. So you have to go in and you have to prune it, you have to trim different branches and stuff, and you have to like reshape it sometimes into the form that's aesthetically pleasing and the desired end result. And the thing that I like about the bonsai thing is you have to be very careful when you do that. You know, if you go willy-nilly, you can either destroy the form or you can kill the tree. And obviously that's absolutely not what we wanted to do at all. So we started work on this stuff, and very early on we were like, this is such a big deal, and we were kind of in a phase where we didn't exactly know what was going to happen. We didn't entirely have a date set in mind yet. We just knew we needed to talk about it. So we were talking about we need a code name for it, you know, just to make sure, because it wasn't even company-wide knowledge, because the last thing we wanted to do was set people on a path and have them think something was coming when we weren't really sure when it was coming and stuff. Mm-hmm. So one of our, I don't remember who it was, but we were in a meeting and they were like, so we need a code name. And we talked about a couple different things. And somebody was just like, let's just call it Egg Roll. And we were like, okay, why not? Like, it was kind of like a lark at the time. And then it became this thing. And now it has dominated my life for the last 4 years and a lot of people's lives in Privateer. The story there is, be careful what you name things, because you have to live with it for a long time.
During the course of the project, Will.
Yeah.
Like 4 years. You know, for big projects like this, 4 years is about right. You know, that's the time that it takes. But
yes,
we have seen some almost seismic shifts in how games are enjoyed and how games are consumed during that period. Did you guys find yourselves having to go back to the whiteboard a couple of times and say, do you know what, let's see if what we're thinking still jives with where we think the industry's kind of headed?
You know, I think, so obviously we did have a long lead time. Part of the 4 years, though, that was really nice is that we were effectively in some ways, you know, really tapping the existing community of War Machine and Hordes for kind of our input and feedback. They didn't know it, but we were paying very close attention to what they were saying, the things that were coming up. Obviously, some industry trends in terms of miniature games and what people were kind of gravitating towards had some impact. But by and large, we knew that what we had, just based on the fact that our community continued to grow and to grow at rates that were just still phenomenal to us, we knew like everything was healthy, everything was pretty solid. What we really needed to do, though, is we needed to make sure that we were really drilling in and creating that play experience that was going to appeal to everyone. And so we definitely did make some slight, you know, course alterations and we evaluated a lot of stuff that was coming out. But at the end of the day, you know, we never wound up in a place where we're like, we have to radically change X, Y, or Z, right? Yeah. In the end, it was a lot of like little dial turning. There are a couple of significant things that, you know, when you see them at the first glance, you're like, wow, that seems like a pretty significant change. You know, the power-up mechanic obviously is one that from an external view, the first time you see that, you're like, that's huge. Now Warjacks suddenly get a free focus every turn as long as they're within control range of their Warcaster.
Mm-hmm. I like.
And you know, and it does definitely impact their efficiency on the table, what you can do with them, the kind of list build you get. But at the same time, it doesn't feel like a new game. It just feels like, why, you know, now it's just a natural thing. It's like, that should always be there. We definitely, like, throughout the time of development, you know, as we're working on this stuff, we would go to conventions and we would obviously play games with people because it's what we love to do. We love to play with the community. And it was tough at times to be like, oh yeah, that's right, he doesn't get that free focus anymore. So there's a great story. So we're at SmogCon 2 years ago, and it's myself and Ed Burrell, and we're playing in an 8-man scramble event. And you know, I finished my game before Ed, and so I'm walking over just to see how he's doing. And he's got his little Warwitch siren, he's running around, and he had I think it was a Slayer or a Seether or maybe a Harrow, it was a Helljack, and it already had a focus point on him. And he's like, okay, so the Warwitch siren's gonna power boost my Jack there and give it another focus. And his opponent kind of looked at me, he's like, I don't think you can do that. And it's like, no, I can totally do that. He picks up the card. I'm like, no, Ed, no, you can't do that. You think of an old rule.
I'm assuming this is you running up going, no, gag him, no!
I know, I was like, stop talking, man. So I had to play it off, and I was like, no, you're just thinking of like an old playtest rule. Not that he was thinking about the new system. I was like, you're thinking about the old playtest rule. And he looked at me, and for a second, like, you can never tell with Ed. I was just waiting for him to say something like that would totally just escalate the situation. Because you could tell, like, in his head, he knew he was right. And I'm like, you're kind of right, but you need to be quiet right now, which I can't say. And so finally he's like, oh, yeah, we have so many rules, like, rustling around our head. I'm sure I just forgot it. And I was like, okay. That was my favorite, like, that was my favorite because it was like the natural, like, oh, I can do this thing. And no, you really can't.
Yeah, so hang on. That guy, no, if he happens to be watching this, is going to go, damn it, I caught something and I missed it.
That's what happened. So, there definitely were, like, there were probably, like, slight slips like that. And to be fair, it happens, you know, it's just as natural to remember an old playtest rule as a new playtest rule. But that one was really funny. In the end, though, right, it really came down to making sure that what we finally came up with was true to everything that is War Machine and Hordes, but better. Like, in the end, we just wanted to supercharge everything and build it for, you know, the next 5, 10, 20 years, right? To reshape the game and make sure that it was set to go. And we were lucky in that everything we had was pretty much there, right? All of the core fundamentals were still solid and thriving and very robust and lively. It just came down to, like, shaping those branches that came off the trunk of the tree.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the kind of the signatures of a great game is that when you go through an exercise like this, you can find a balance between creating a game that is streamlined enough for new players to be able to have a comfortable experience getting in those first steps, but also have a game that is still deep enough and interesting enough for the legacy of players that you've already built to be able to look at it and just drool with anticipation.
Yes, of getting it and mining the meta.
Or the two don't have to be mutually exclusive. There is certainly a battle in terms of game design between the two constituents, because obviously if those new players are relying on that depth in order to be able to fully enjoy the game, it becomes difficult for them. Mm-hmm. But if they find an easier way in and then can unlock the depth during their journey through the game, do you guys feel that this new version is going to play that role? You know, are you how important was new blood to you guys whenever you were looking at this system?
You know, I mean, like, obviously new players and seeing the community grow is something that we are intensely passionate about, right? Like, effectively, we want to share these games with everyone. We want them, you know, the ideal is that they appeal to everyone, that we can walk anywhere in the world and have conversations about War Machine and Hordes, about the play experience, like to have that instant connection, because that's me, and we talk about that a lot, I think, just in general, that community connection, that kind of like vibe that you get at a convention where you've never met this person before, but all of a sudden you have this common language in the games and in what you do and the painting and the hobby and all that stuff. That's incredible. And so to propagate that, you know, like a virus is amazing. And that obviously is a highly desired thing. Like you said, though, you know, the trick is that you really have to realize, and one of the things that we keep to heart, is that you never want to do anything at the expense of the existing community, the people who are invested, who have helped shape and mold, you know, the thing that you love. And so when we approached the new edition, it really was with an eye to, you know, how do we streamline and make the games better? Not necessarily for the new player, although we did do things like with the new battle group boxes, with some of the new formats that you're going to be seeing coming out, and Hungerford will be talking about in the future, to make that entry point lower barrier, you know, to help shepherd new players in and to make the experience a little easier to digest and grow into. But really, we were looking at, you know, a lot of the streamlining and the rebalancing and stuff with an eye to even our, you know, our world championship players, the people who are completely enmeshed in the game and live and breathe it for all, you know, all of their free time, probably, or most of their free time. The game was to a point where there was so much that it was, you know, it was not even really possible for them to be able to understand it all, to grasp it all. And when you get to that point, it's at that point where you have to be like, okay, how do we simplify it for everyone? How do we cut down on things? And so a lot of what we did was look at rules that were similar but slightly different, and then basically taking those and mashing them all together and making one rule, right? One rule to rule them all. Where, so you'll see a lot of things will look very similar, but you know, the people who know like every ability by heart will be like, well, that ability's gone and that ability's gone, but it was a lot like this ability, now this ability is just in those three places.
Yeah.
And that, well, a small tweak, you know, in the end, because you're really not changing what the models do necessarily. You might have like small variations in timing or whatever for the abilities that now they do things differently because they're all codified with that one ability that was really the core of what you were shooting for, is immense in terms of when you apply it over the aggregate. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, in the end, what that does is it makes the game more enjoyable, more fun for the people who are veterans of it, who have been playing it for a long time. And it kind of removes some of the pressure, I think, that, you know, and through our interactions and our intense watching of the community, we were seeing this stuff come up. We were seeing, you know, kind of that fatigue of there's so much and there's so many complexities now that even I, as somebody who's been in for 5-10 years, am getting overwhelmed. It's becoming too complex. Mm-hmm. And so at that point you're like, okay, let's start just shaving off some of that. And you do it by a slow, gradual process. And that's what we basically did over 4 years, is rebalancing stuff and then really trying to bring it back in line without losing any of that tactical depth and you know, everything that makes the games enjoyable and fun and deep and rich.
Yeah.
And it was a rewarding and very challenging experience.
In terms of richness of experience, now you'd mentioned formats. I'm not sure if you can talk about this yet or if this is info that's coming out later, but are we likely to see changes, additions to the ways that we enjoy War Machine and Hordes. You know, it's a format's a big thing.
Yeah, no, absolutely. One of the goals that we set out with, you know, you talk a little bit about looking at the industry and looking at other miniatures games and what lessons you can take from them. Primarily, you know, through watching the community and interacting with our community and looking at other communities out there and kind of what was appealing and stuff. What we realized is that we really wanted to show people, because I think this has always been true, it just hasn't necessarily been at the front and center, is that you can experience War Machine and Hordes at a whole bunch of different levels if you want to. And what we needed to do in the new edition was really dive in and make those different experiences, you know, front and center and potentially a little more developed, so that they were viable right out of the box. And we started really with the process, you know, we started with the battle group boxes. And that level of just the Warcaster and their battle group, 4 or 5 models on the table, sometimes 3 if you're playing heavy armor Kador, was the core. And that literally is how we started the whole new edition. The whole process of the new edition started with those battle group boxes. And we played game after game of battle group box level, like, playtest games to dial in that experience, to make sure that what we were offering as the entry point for new players, or even as that, I kind of just want a quick, like, 20-minute match that's going to test me a little bit, but, like, is going to be fast and fun and furious, was exactly what we needed it to be. And so, you know, the battle group boxes that now are coming out with the new edition, I think really are the best that we've ever done in terms of just presenting the game as, here's the basic level, here's the core, here's the beating heart of these games, and you can play it over and over again and get something out of it every time, because there's tactical choice, there's depth, it plays just right. From there, you know, we moved on and we started really diving into the standard game, but we realized, again, that what we needed was, we kind of needed an interim, a step in between. And so not everybody has like a 4x4 table. Not every retailer is able to put on a tournament that has, you know, 12 or 16 or however many 4x4 table players they need. So we started looking at how do you experience War Machine Hordes on different table setups, smaller table setups. What does that do for the game experience? And Hungerford's going to be talking about this in Insider, so I can't really go into it too much. But where we landed is actually really exciting. It's War Machine and Hordes, but a new expression of War Machine and Hordes that changes the way you have to approach army building. It changes your tactics and strategies, but it's still War Machine and Hordes. The best experience, or the best kind of statement that I've heard about it that I think is just absolutely on the nose, is that the new kind of in-between format from battle group to standard game feels like War Machine on round 3. Like, that's basically when the game starts.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, it has done so many cool things, both in terms of, you know, the space, the time required, because obviously the games play more fast and furious. Mm. You're not necessarily limited to smaller, like, I'm not talking about smaller armies necessarily.
Yeah.
There's definitely a cap just based on the table size, but, like, you can experience this kind of, like, new format at various point levels, you know, almost all the way up to what we consider standard now, which is 75 points, which is basically the same as 50 in Mark II. But it radically changes which Warcasters or Warlocks kind of dominate necessarily or have an easier time with it. Mm. You get to see, you know, heavy hitter casters, and Warlocks that want to get in your face, kind of, they're on the higher end of the curve as compared to, like, your Harbingers and stuff, because they're starting at a point in this new format where they're right there. They're right where they need to be to start wrecking face.
Yeah. And sounds a lot more brutal for your gameplay.
Yeah, absolutely. And so it changes a lot of stuff, and yet we've been very careful and managed to come up with a really cool way in which the closeness that you start with is totally balanced. So, you know, there's, as long as you make semi-smart choices in round 1, there is no fear of, like, first turn, first round assassinations.
Yeah.
And so that's been really exciting to do. And then, of course, we have an eye as we move forward into the editions to kind of continue to open up those various experiences to where we want to basically be able to offer a War Machine and Hordes version of just about every game size and experience possible. So, you know, and that means from the battle group box level all the way up to kind of, like, the Unbound level and the stuff that we will wind up doing with that, you know, in the future as the new edition starts to solidify and people start to get in tune with it. you know, we have a lot of really cool stuff on the docket that in the end, our goal is to make sure that no matter what kind of experience you want, you can get it in some manner that is unique to War Machine and Hordes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It sounds to me that the work and the effort that's been put into the battle boxes has been quite immense, because it's not just a collection of models that have just been chucked in there. It seems to have been very finely tuned to allow people to really experience where you're headed with the new edition.
Well, it's the quintessential flavor for the faction that you're choosing. It has to be, this is the Kador starter set, this feels Kador to me. This feels like the Frozen North with tons of heavy armor and icy warcasters.
Now, warcasters themselves are kind of, or maybe evolving a little bit. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Well, so for the battle group boxes specifically, you know, one of the fun yet very difficult challenges with those is that we knew we wanted to introduce new warcasters and warlocks into those boxes. We wanted to have kind of a new class of characters for the new edition. And, you know, you talked a little bit, and I think you guys hit on the nose, is that those battle group boxes are more than just here's how you start in the game. This is here's how you start in this faction. Here's from just a look, you know, at the exterior model content, from reading the flavor text, from looking at the rules and the models. The idea, the goal is that those boxes immediately bring you into what the core tenets of the faction are. And so you look at High Exemplar Krios or Commander Sorsha or Kaya the Wildborn, right? Lilith. Those warlocks and warcasters absolutely, you know, embody the core tenets of the faction. You can look at Krios and you know, here's, you know, religious iconography. He looks like, you know, a holy knight. Mm-hmm. His spell list is full of fire and burning stuff. His feet is this creator's wrath knocking everybody down. There's ideas of like anti-magic with Spellbreaker and stuff like that. So right away, it's very easy to immediately capture the essence of what Protectorate is. Mm-hmm. And obviously, the factions are more multi-layered than those battle group boxes, but the core is all there. It immediately tells you, as somebody who's never heard of any of this stuff before, well, this is what I gravitate towards. This is the truth of that faction,
and I can build out from there. In my mind.
Mm-hmm. And so with the new characters, we had to do that, but we had to do that while making them, you know, interesting and unique and standalone in themselves. We wanted to make new characters. We didn't just want to reskin Sorsha, for example. Mm-hmm. We wanted Kozlov to have his own identity, his own kind of tie into the faction, but yet represent everything that Kador is, you know.
Yeah.
Heavy armor, hard hitting, very resilient, highly dedicated to duty, kind of like stalwart and stoic.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was really fun to kind of dive into that stuff. And then, of course, we also had to look at them through the lens of, okay, this is how somebody who's never possibly played a miniatures game before in their life is going to come into these games. They're going to pick up this box, and this is going to be their first experience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you want to make sure, you know, we had to make sure that those characters, those new casters, worked perfectly in sync with their battle groups. You know, the game is, at its core, it's about the battle group. And so making sure that they boosted their battle group's efficiency. But yet, as you expanded, they also had reason to take troops and worked with the armies overall.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a really bending puzzle to kind of come up with this stuff. And that's before you even start talking about personal motivations and story arcs and things like that, which we're always very, very focused on as well when we're doing character development and model development, is that, you know, these characters don't just exist on the tabletop. They exist in a world. They exist in the Iron Kingdoms. Mm-hmm. And we want them to feel like living, breathing, you know, people with their own goals, aspirations, and challenges. And so you mesh all that together, and it's amazing to me sometimes that we can do all that in 4 years.
Yeah.
But, you know, at the end, the experience is really rewarding. And I think that, you know, I'm so excited to see this kind of be the new class for the new edition. Like, these are the characters that will kind of carry us forward in many ways, and just what they bring to both the tabletop experience, to the new players, to representing their factions, is super exciting.
No, it's not only about rules, Will, is it? You know, a new edition is a new opportunity for the story arc to move forward a bit. What are we looking at in terms of the where the background is headed for this new edition?
So, you know, one of the big things about the new edition, which Doug has talked about a little bit, but we'll be going into more detail as the new edition begins to roll out, is the fact that through Wrath of the Dragon Father from Skull Island Expeditions, and the upcoming Doug Seacat novel, Blood of Kings, the story arc from Mark II comes to a conclusion. We see a lot of the loose ends tied up. They're completely wrapped up. And from there, the really exciting thing about the new edition is we jump a couple years forward in the timeline. So the new edition really does start a new era of War Machine and Hordes. Now, we haven't at all erased the history of what came before. In fact, that's absolutely crucial to the new starting point in the new edition 2 years later. But the cool thing about the kind of time jump is that it really opens up what is going to happen in the world. Kind of the things that you thought you knew in terms of the factions and their roles within the story are going to, in some cases, drastically change. And I think like that in and of itself is pretty exciting because we're going to get to explore character stories and faction stories and stuff in a very exciting and new way. And with Skull Island Expeditions now being established in a much more dynamic and faster paced way, you know, we're no longer going to be tied to kind of telling the overarching narrative through the game books themselves. We're now going to be able to explore characters really in depth in terms of their impact on the story and kind of like in a total universe perspective through Skull Island and its various releases. So that I think will really change just kind of the richness and the ability of people to dive in and become involved with the world and these characters. Unlike anything that's come before in any of the previous editions. Yeah. And so that from, you know, Doug's standpoint or people who, you know, Matt Wilson's standpoint, people who love and breathe and live the world is just as exciting, if not more exciting, than the new editions and what they mean to the tabletop.
Right. Last question for you, Will. I'm a big proponent of being able to game in the gaps. something that I have longed for a very long time, and I'm just wondering if there's been any rumblings of it in behind the scenes there, but the ability to kind of create your own war caster.
Or warlock.
Any possibilities?
I would say there's absolutely a possibility, and that it's something that we are currently actually in the process of, and that's on the docket, and well, it'll be a little bit, and we'll have to come back to it, and we can talk more about it when we get closer to that date. I think you'll be very happy.
So Warzone, the Terror of Kislev shall be landing on the tabletop.
I am over the moon. That is like music to my ears. Look, Will, thank you so much for dropping in with us today to tell us about it. We will get you back on as we get closer to the release date, because I'm sure there's going to be a ton of other questions that are going to brew up as you guys start releasing the little details and snippets of what we've got coming. But thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me, guys. I look forward to coming back and talking more about it.
Absolutely. Okay, guys, let's tell you about some hubs.
Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastofwar.com. Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastofwar.com.
Oh, I am looking forward to this like nothing else.
You are excited about this, aren't you?
Do you know why?
Why?
Do you know why? Because when I was in England, I got to play War Machine all the time, and it was glorious and beautiful and wonder, and my Signar, oh, my mighty Signar. Unfortunately, I moved home, and now I can't find players to play with. So, with a new edition, hopefully I can get some new people in the local area to actually start playing the game. So that's what has me more excited than anything.
You're going to get the big books, and you're going to club people over the head and drag them to
your
War
Machine. You will play it.
And sail away with them and go, there you go, now you have to play with me.
No, it...
Except maybe not like that.
Right, on a serious note, it was actually something we were talking about is that lowering barriers to entry. Because at this stage of War Machine, someone coming into it, they have quite the mountain to climb to actually get up to the top levels. With a reset of the rules, it means everybody's starting on that even playing field again, and new players can jump in and start to, you know, bring themselves up the ranks with the older veterans. Now, yes, the older veterans might get there quicker, but it gives everyone a good starting point, and I love the fact.
But surely,
that
surely the new rules aren't messing with the synergies and stuff.
No,
you know, characters who worked well before are still going to work well now, and seasoned players are going to know this and kick the ass off newbies like me.
Yes, but they've changed the core rules.
Right.
So some of those key synergies that you used to rely on might not work anymore. Mm. You know, I mean, like that's one of the key things of this. With the core set change, it means everybody's getting reset to zero, or at least very damn close to zero. And so, that's going to make it really interesting.
So you're saying it's now is the time to jump in on Warmachine Hordes.
Now is the time. If you've been looking at Warmachine and thinking, I might give this a go, as soon as those new starter sets hit, get in and pick the one you like. The other thing is that colored plastic is fantastic because it goes back to an old conversation we had ages ago. What's the minimum level you're happy having stuff on the table at? Guess what? Privateer got you colored plastic already. You get this built, you can put that on the table and I'd be happy with it.
What's the colored plastic going to be in?
It's in each faction color. And I think it's a PVC material they're using, if I
and
remember
this
correctly.
This is in the new starter boxes
in
or something?
In the new starter boxes. Each starter set is done to its faction color.
So, sort of the way they did in, what was it, Grind?
Yes. The old board game that
the materials come on since then.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, from the color
similar idea. So that you can just put it on the table after it's built. You know, I mean, like, say it's a new kid that's starting up.
Yeah.
They know nothing about painting. They can put something together and it's going to look good once they get it down on the table before they start painting. So they could actually wait to learn a little bit.
But when it comes to Warmachine Hordes, I can't see people not wanting to paint their minis very long.
Of course.
Because you don't need that many, and they're pretty big, and they've got lovely details that are easy to get in at with your brush. You're not sitting trying to go, where did this plate vanish to? Trying to imagine where the detail is. It's all there. It's all waiting to be painted. Mm. Ben.
Yes.
What do you think of these updates for Warmachine Hordes then?
I think it's really great. I mean, I collected Kador and the Trollbloods, and I'm really waiting to get back into the Trollbloods and pick up that new box. Mm-hmm. Talking about the boxes, I think that's one of the big things for this that will really bring people into it. Making it really accessible for new players to get stuck in with everything they need to play. So they get the dice, they get a mat, a little bit of terrain, all the books as well, which help them guide them forward through into picking up additional models and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I just think these are a really great step in the right direction for Privateer Press, and I can't see this going wrong in any sense of the word. Yeah,
the sets are really cool, and as you said, Justin, right now looking at it, yes, the factions are all in their colored plastic.
Yeah, which I really like. The other thing is, it's a new Warcaster for each battle box with a slight retune on the jacks that are in there. So, yes, one of the major things for Warmachine is, once you change out your Warcaster, that completely changes the feel of your army. But there are times if you just go and grab a random Warcaster and stick it in with your old army, none of the synergies are going to work. So it's good to see that they've actually taken the time to think about it and say, okay, here's the new Warcaster for the starter set. Here's what they're going to need to run with them to actually make this actually work and be effective.
Yeah.
You know, so the other thing is this is a new breed of Warcaster we're seeing here, and they're designed specifically to run with a battle group, which is really important.
Oh my goodness, I hadn't even checked this one out. This
Legion
is
of Everblight.
Awesome
that
looking.
Is cool.
Yeah, yeah. So you've got a couple of little shredders there, a Nephilim, and I think that's a Seraph with the wings, if I remember correctly, because my main opponent used to actually be a Legion player. He was a nightmare to beat. You've then obviously got these guys here, the Scorn. You've got your Titan Gladiator. Yeah. You've got your Cyclopses. You've got your new guy. They just look fantastic, don't they? And Ben, you're Trollbloods. I love the look of the new Trollbloods.
Oh yeah, definitely
so
going for Trollbloods when this
so
comes
beefy.
Out.
When it comes to Hordes, it's usually been the Trollbloods that have been appealing to me.
Yeah.
So I love that. I love that chunk. I love the big chunky fingers.
Mm. that's a heroic skill, you know.
Yeah, but they've got really big fingers, Dustin. Just awesome big fists.
Okay.
I just think it look class. But that other faction.
The Legion of Everblight.
Oh my goodness, that looks amazing in the winged beastie.
I don't know. My heart's always been Signar, so I'm gonna have to stick with that when it comes out. Ben, is it gonna be Trollbloods for you?
Totally Trollbloods, all the way. Love Hordes as a system. Mm. I much prefer it to War Machine. Hopefully that'll carry over into Mark III. I'm gonna stick with the Trollbloods, I think. Yeah.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see how the dynamics change, because focus was always a set resource you were getting at the start of your turn.
Yep.
Whereas with the Fury, it was something that you were trying to burn and bleed off your actual Warbeast to stop them going crazy and actually mauling the closest thing to them whenever they rampaged. Yep. So it's going to be interesting to see how that changes and the tweaks that Privateer have made.
Awesome. Awesome stuff. Right, I'm going to move us on. Mm. I think let's talk a bit more about Salute 2016. Because my goodness, that show.
It gets better every year.
It's intense.
It is.
It gets more intense every year. Because we turned up and we're like, we're going to live blog this. And the team's all getting pumped and hyped and ready to go.
And Warren's dying on his feet.
from drinking too much.
Thanks
to backstagers.
Let's be honest. We all had more than a skinful on the Friday night.
Justin was ridiculous. It was his birthday.
Yeah.
On the Thursday before, I couldn't turn around. I would stand up, go out for a breath of air, come back in, and there's maybe two more drinks sitting, and I'm just going, what did you
two? Yeah. You had six drinks sitting in front of you, and one in your hand at one point.
Yeah.
And two of those six drinks were cocktails this size.
Yeah, yeah.
Lovely big pink-purple cocktails.
Pink cocktails. They were something on the beach, for those of you that know.
And what was the other one? A screaming something?
No, it was just that one. That one, but no,
you
I think
you had that twice.
I had four of those. I had four of those.
You had.
Then I had two double vodka and coke, and then I think I had about eight strawberry and lime Copperberg. Yeah. So I was pretty well done for a birthday night's drinking. I was pretty well done. You were well on yourself though. But the best one had to be Warren that night. Just seeing him, they put him on shorts, which is just spirits with ice, and it was glorious to see, because I could just see him after the first couple. The hair came down, just got a little bit messy, looked a little less polished, and then the blethering started, the Ganshin. It was beautiful.
The Ganshin.
Yeah.
That would be my
The Ganshin and the blethering, so in other words, talking crap.
Don, you were enjoying our backstage meetups and stuff.
Yes, it was a good time. It was good to meet people. It was very fun to sit back and watch everybody be crazy. So, you know, we played games, we had some drinks.
I prefer eccentric, madam.
Yeah, eccentric is probably a spot on description.
Exactly. There was nobody going, ah!
No, it wasn't. Far, right? No, it was controlled chaos. It was.
Still chaos.
Until part of the group left. And everybody was like, where'd they go?
That was the Saturday night.
That was where the adventure started.
Yeah, that was the Saturday night. Anyway. Long story short, the backstage destroyed us.
Yeah.
Right before salute. We're supposed to have an easy night on the Friday night, so we're effective on the Saturday night. But every year, the backstage has been destroying us more and more.
I think it's become its own game, would you say?
You see, I try to survive through it by drinking nothing but Guinness.
Yeah.
But boy, do I feel heavy and suffer the next day. I'm trying to go around salute, and I'm thinking, I'm about 10 stone heavier than I should be today.
Well, for me, I actually hadn't had a big session of drinking in any recent amount of time before that. So this was me going in and just going, okay, I'm going to have a couple. Where'd this come from? Why is this here? Guys, come on, please. At which point I was just told, go on, knock it in you. Don't be a big girl's blouse about it.
But yeah, point, let me go back to my point. My point is, we walked in, the hall was still going through final setup.
Yeah.
And it suddenly dawned on me, oh my goodness, there is far too much here for us to be able to cover effectively in 7 hours. Because that's what you get. Yeah. You get 7 hours. You get from 10 o'clock to 5 o'clock.
Right.
Then you got to be gone.
Yep.
You have to be out. There's no hanging about.
Do you know how many vendors were?
I had Ben do a wee tally for us. Ben, give us some number crunching.
Right, so I counted all the vendors on the sheet that they had, and I think it came up to around 280 separate vendors in some way or another.
Yeah.
So they might have shared booths, or they might have been split and stuff like that, but there were around 280 vendors there. So,
yikes. Yeah.
And tables, gaming tables?
And then there were also 80 participation / demo games as well. So loads and loads of things for people to see. Far too much to try and take in one day. It's absolutely insane. But I think the things that you do see when you're at Salute will stick with you for a long time. Just the memories there are fantastic. Yeah.
After I hear you give those numbers, I feel a little better about how much we've sat back and looked at the coverage and gone, where was that? How come I didn't see that? That's how come I didn't see that.
I'm having these moments, right? Because we have our live blog out there. Yeah. If you haven't checked it out, we go out and we make videos during the event, and then we run back to our control room and we hand them off to this person and that person. Here's your photos. Here's your video. Get this out. Get that out. Get this out.
And we're gone.
Time lapse this. Music that. And go. And it's like that for like 7 hours.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just non-stop. And I mean, the live blog has 5,000 comments on it. People
That's
trying
crazy.
To win prizes.
Crazy.
That's
I love it.
Crazy numbers.
I love it.
But like you say, when you're there, you're like, oh, this is amazing. That's amazing. Mm-hmm. And when you leave, you check the stuff that we've been working on.
You're like, what did you see?
I didn't see that.
I saw what I covered.
I think I got like 30 minutes to run around the event and do my shopping for some.
You had Ben do half your shopping. Red Ben. We just threw money at Red Ben.
No, because he actually couldn't find what I was looking for.
Oh, all right.
We'll get onto that in backstage.
Ben, do you remember when Justin told us that someone at Salute had a personal shopper?
Oh, yeah. Now it's Justin.
I still didn't realize he was talking about himself.
Whoa, hang on. I asked a friend from the site for a favor who stopped in with us. I couldn't get time to get away. There was one miniature I wanted. I said, could you maybe run and pick this up for me? That is not a personal shopper. That is a friend doing a favor for a friend.
It's a personal shopper.
I didn't pay him to do it.
Point is, if we wanted to cover absolutely everything that's going at Salute, we'd need about 10 more people.
Yeah.
We'd need at least three times the size of team there.
I'd need three dedicated video editors.
Yeah.
Three dedicated film crews.
I'd want four.
10 hours instead of seven.
Yeah.
And I'd want at least three or four people dedicated just to taking photographs.
But I think it's awesome because it means that you can come away from the event and come and watch like the live blog or check out Mel, the train tutor.
Mm-hmm.
He does a cracking video. He's done one last year. I think he's done one this year where he basically just concentrates on the gaming tables.
Yeah.
Because train's his thing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I had a brief look at his video and I didn't see that.
Right.
I didn't see that.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, that's amazing. And then I went to Templar's Crusade to see what Brian had up.
Aye, that's Brian Hassan.
And immediately I'm going, I didn't see that. I didn't see that. And I bet you the same fellas are coming over to our blog and going, I didn't see
right.
that.
Right, yeah.
That's what's awesome about Salute and terrible about Salute at the same time.
I have
7 hours.
Yeah.
I like that though, because it's very high pressure. Get in, I'm excited. I want to get my stuff as quickly as I can.
Yeah. It's really different from the likes of Gen Con and Adepticon.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's a different kind of crazy. It really is. And I said it last year, and I'm saying it again. I cannot believe that gets pulled off in one day.
Mm-hmm.
Truly.
Yeah.
Set up and then take down, and everybody's got to be out. I mean, it's insanity.
Although, honestly, I would love to get a sense of the vibe of Gen Con, to actually go to Gen Con and just get a sense of it, you know, for 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be absolutely fantastic.
Come on over. Come on over.
If I can get time, I can convince Warren, I'm there.
Right, so one particular did we enjoy about Salute this year? Apart from the mayhem.
Yeah.
Anybody got any particular favorites? Ben, I'm going to come to you first.
Okay, well, yeah, my great thing about this was actually going out and doing some videos and looking at all the really cool gaming tables. So I was wandering around doing a couple of bits and pieces here and there, and a couple of them really caught my eye. One of them was done by the guys at Crooked Dice, and this was showing off the rules for 7TV. And they were looking at a Star Wars game called The Escape from Mos Eisley. Really awesome looking table where you're playing as like Han and Chewie and Luke and old Ben Kenobi trying to race towards the Millennium Falcon. Escape from Mos Eisley was really awesome. There was also some historical stuff there as well that was really great. There was a Battle of Fotaviken, which was this really awesome Viking and Saxon table where the Vikings are coming in across the sea, landing on the beaches and trying to destroy the town while the Saxons are trying to fight them back and stuff.
Wasn't it just amazing, that table, Ben?
It really was fantastic.
We hung around that table for probably more time than we should have just taken it all in.
I'm fairly sure you were down there with your camera taking as many close-up shots as possible, trying to get like inside the houses for like proper cinematic looks and stuff like that. Yeah, it was really cool. Yeah, but as well as that, they had some good stuff there, which is something that I've never really heard of before, called a moving diorama. And it's where they set out a table to represent a battle. In this case, it was the Battle of Willemstad, which was almost this semi-fictitious one, set during, I think it was the Seven Years' War, I think.
Yeah.
And it was basically throughout the day, they moved the forces in the way that they would have acted on the day and stuff like that. And it was just really cool to look at it. This guy had spent, I think it was 3 years, maybe longer than that, making this battle. And it was just fantastic to look at. There was a great sort of field structure outside of it, and then a town that he'd done as well. Most of it had been sort of handcrafted by himself and things. It was really good. You should go and check out those interviews. But yeah, basically as a whole, all the tables were really, really good. Some good stuff from Foreground there as well. There was a nice Frostgrave one, which was fantastic. Yeah, good stuff.
Awesome, awesome stuff. Justin, I'm going to come to you. What was your favorite thing of the event?
For me, it was getting to stop off with the guys at Saga, because I'm loving my Viking Warfare at the minute. And hearing the fact that they've actually got a new campaign system coming out just really excites me. Because so far, whenever we've been playing it in the club, it's been very much just a stand-up fight. You know, just two warbands meet on the tabletop and batter seven shades of hell out of each other. Now that we can actually throw a little more story behind it, I'm really liking that idea. On top of that, I really enjoyed the Saturday night out for Warren Stag Do. No, it's... Yeah, I know you're going to laugh, but it's one of the things I really love is actually getting to meet people from the mm-hmm. website and actually sit down and put a face to the username, if you get what yeah. I mean. That and getting to meet the companies that we work alongside, because I must have spent half the night chatting to Protos on the Saturday, and I spent a little bit of time with the guys from FatMat that do the gaming mats. Yeah. Just chatting away to them was great, great fun.
It is fun. It is fun meeting the backstagers and stuff mm-hmm. and coming up. But it's the next year when you meet them again, you're like, I had a lot of drinks that night. I can just about summage up your username.
No, you see, I've just turned 30, so my brain hasn't went quite so fuzzy just yet.
Because people catch me out with it all the time. They're like, yeah. They'll walk up and you go,
hey, how you doing?
Hey, how you doing? And they'll go, you don't remember me, Lloyd? And I'm like, oh, sure, dude. We've met loads of times. And they'll go, we've met once.
One time. No.
Yeah. Like, well, damn.
I will admit that does get worse whenever you have one community member who has the genius, brilliant idea of bringing a bottle of Pochin with him. For those of you who do not know what Pochin is, for our American viewers, that's moonshine. Thankfully, it's legalized now, so we're not going to jail.
Moonshine made of spuds, Justin. Give him the whole story.
Potato vodka. Very nice stuff. Warren went on to it on the Saturday night, and it was just...
Actually, the guy who brought that over was actually on a good crack, because I spent a bit of time talking to him.
Aye, he's a southerner.
But he brought over the poaching, but what he didn't bring over was his dust army. Because I spent about an hour saying, you don't really need that anymore, do you? Yeah. I'm not giving it to you. You don't really need that anymore, do you? I'm not giving it to you. I was hoping as you get more drunk, you probably just
right? You just have to keep working on him. You might be able to get there.
People complain to me about blagging stuff. Lloyd, that's nasty.
He brought poaching.
Yeah. Actually, fair point. All bets are off whenever the poaching comes out last. Although it was really funny feeding it to some of the people that were there visiting as well, because we gave it to Yarick from Protos. Yeah. He looked at it, knocked it down, and it was just deadpan. Not bad. How strong is it? 61.1%?
67.
Or was it? No, was it 67?
67%.
I think it was 61%.
No, 67.
All right, fine. It was 67%. He looked at it and went, oh, it's only 67%. That's fine. Don't worry, lads. I'll send you across a bottle of absinthe later in the year.
Okay.
So.
let me recap here, right? Yeah. So, we've come to Ben.
Yes.
And I've asked, what do you like about Salute? And he's like, really gaming tables and this and that and the other. And I come to you, what do you like about Salute?
Drinking.
Getting people drunk.
Yeah.
Backstagers.
No. I liked going to see the guys at Saga, but it was the meetups that really made it for me this year. It was getting to spend time with the community.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's my excuse. I'm sticking to it.
Dawn, what about yourself?
All right, so...
did you have a good Salute? Was there stuff that stood out for you?
It was the best. And the highlight for me, selfishly, was finally getting to meet Shane Cook, the artist that drew Jezebel for me, and talking to Paranoid Miniatures, and picking up my mini from Protos, who absolutely did a beautiful job.
Yeah.
Justin, I'll let
you
put
now when you say up. Shane Cook, he did the illustration.
He did the illustration, yes, because that's what we started with. Originally, it wasn't going to be a miniature, but it was after, you know, he gave that amazing artwork to me. It was like, I just can't leave it there. Yeah. Let's take this to the next level. So we put it into the wizard's hands over at Protos, and that's what we ended up with.
Yeah.
But then, when I was talking to the guys over at Paranoid, they surprised me because they actually wrote me my own set of rules to use Jezebel in Mythos, which is awesome. So, you know, in that game, it's designed, you know, according to how much sanity they have. They play either or side of their character cards, and so they put Jezebel as she is on the box on the front side of the card, and then her insanity flip is the old hag, which is that secondary art piece that Shane did, which was unbelievable.
Nice.
And the really cool thing is she does have a special rule on there where if your name is Dawn, you get +2 instead of +1 bonus on there. So Justin pointed out.
I have a quick question here because I asked this at the event, but I'll ask it again.
Yeah.
If I wear a name tag saying, hello, my name is Dawn,
I think
do
that
I get
counts.
The special rule?
If you're willing to be called it for the remainder of the game, I think it would totally count, don't you think?
I'm up for that.
So you walk up to the gaming table and you go, hi, I'm Dawn. I'm here to kick your ass.
I will be known as Dawn for the remainder of the game.
Just, hello, my name is.
Yes.
And then just write Dawn on it and just wear that for the rest of the day.
You know, if you're dedicated enough,
that's the rule.
There you go. Yeah, so that was just absolutely amazing for me. But then, you know, getting to talk more with them, I thought it was super cool that they shared the announcement that they're going to do a crossover miniature between Paranoid, you know, for Mythos.
We're talking about the Paranoid Miniatures guys and who at this point?
Massive Awesome for Shattered Earth. Yeah, so two extremely different games with very, very story-driven themes mm-hmm. that are able to find a common denominator, you know, with use of time and magic or aether, depending yeah. on which universe we're functioning in, and be able to pull a mini between the two games, which is pretty cool because yeah. Yeah. especially if you maybe hadn't thought about getting into one of the other games, it, yeah. it gives like the perfect bridge into yeah. there that you can bounce back and forth. So yeah. that was pretty
I mean, like,
cool.
That was a really cool announcement, mm-hmm. especially the idea that it's written deeply into the fluff that this is what's happening.
Yes.
Because there is magic within both worlds, it affects and sort of creates a wormhole between the worlds. So mm-hmm. you have high sci-fi on one side, Lovecraftian and Cthulhu on the other. What could be better?
Right, right.
Awesome. And I believe that Shane Cook did some more art.
He did, yes. And so we'll make sure we get an image up for you guys. So when they bring Shane to these cons, he sits and he draws while he's there. And like for you and I, we'd say, okay, well, yeah, I'm going to do some sketches while we're somewhere. This is like full-blown finished art. And so he did a picture of Jezebel and the Sea Queen.
Nice.
Arms linked, you know, like besties, you know, forever. It is the coolest picture. And I think I actually, when I shared it on Facebook, I think I put hashtag besties on there. Yeah, it was awesome. He just nice. Is unreal. So
nice. Yeah, Warren's not here, but I'm going to share something that he's probably
to.
Really
yes.
excited about from Select.
Yeah. Yes.
Now, when he was out wandering around, I'm assuming he wandered over towards the Protoss stand, and then Shane's probably come up to him and says, here you go, what do you see what I've
yep.
created for you, based on your love.
I think this may have actually been a wedding gift.
It is a wedding gift,
is it?
Yeah.
Based yep. on his love of Nero Wolfe.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
Right, check this out. So,
for those of you that don't know what Nero Wolfe is, it's an old school detective show that Warren loves to watch on Netflix, I think it is.
No, he does.
And it's very cheesy, it's very much Warren's personality in a TV show. So, if I may, I'm going to be very delicate with this, because if this gets damaged, Warren will cut me
You'll
in two.
You'll get damaged.
So, yes. Here we go. Look at this.
This is Warren.
This is Warren Wool.
So this is him, buck yep. teeth and everything.
Yeah.
Which he's proud of, because someone went, is it not a bit harsh that you've got buck teeth in this? And he went, no.
I've
look
got
at my teeth. That's exactly me. That's
yeah.
me.
Yeah, the other thing is, on the right-hand side of the screen there, that's actually a torch. Warren thought it was a pint.
Oh. You can write it into your own story, I suppose.
Well, you see, this is something I'm wondering, because it says artwork by Andy Cook.
Yeah, we've got story.
By
we've got artwork, Shane Cook.
Yes, apologies.
And then down here we've got story by Gareth, what is that, Burley?
Burley, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is actually leaving me kind of wondering why they've mentioned story on this. Is Warren maybe getting written into the fluff of this? If he is, that's going to be absolutely amazing and epic, and I will love you forever, Warren.
Check out his funky tie.
Right?
Oh, yeah, with the symbols on it.
And he's just getting ready to come around the corner and just kick the Sea Queen's ass. That's
yeah,
the other
that
part
kind of
it.
Come and have a good look on his face.
Yeah. I'm a little bit jealous that I didn't
Are
get
you,
one.
Are you? Oh.
Yeah, yeah. Just a little bit.
Just a little just tiny bit. Like yeah.
Lloyd, eventually, your day will come.
So that's awesome. You've had minis made of you.
Well,
he's
my
had
head.
Minis.
Warren's had a full miniature made of himself. He's now had artwork made of himself.
You see, I go to Salute and I come back with gorilla.
What the hell?
With gorilla glue.
Why do you have gorilla glue?
It's a thought that counts, yeah, Lloyd.
It's a thought that counts.
Right. Why do you have this?
Because we've talked about all this drinking and stuff we were doing. I was sitting having pints.
Aye.
And then some fellas come up and says, Lloyd, here, I've got something for you. And I said, ooh, something for me! So it feels like a miniature or something. I open it up, it's Gorilla Glue!
Gel, shake well.
I think the reason that I'm getting is because I think I've talked about Gorilla Glue and I don't like it.
So they're trying to win you over.
So this is the gel version.
Oh.
Right, to see right. if it'll work.
I think it was the guys from modelshop.co.uk who brought okay. it up to me.
We were quite well oiled at that point.
I'm not sure if it's a shameless plug.
Do with it as you will. Yeah.
But I'm certainly going to try it. I've got some home repairs that need done because I smashed a picture frame last night trying to get into my hobby space because I have this I have this swing, this ladder that swings down out of the attic.
Yeah.
And I just finished putting in pictures.
No!
I print out pictures and put them in a picture frame. Cool. And I was standing back really proud of it. And then I went up in the hobby space and I was closing up in the evening. Smash. Oh. I only just did that.
He just pulled a Clark Griswold.
Gorilla glue to the rescue.
Right?
It even rhymes.
Good stuff.
It was a great event this year, though.
You're not going to ask me what I liked.
Lloyd, what did you like?
I loved what you did like.
Yes.
I got Gorilla Glue. I love this.
Ben touched on it. My favorite thing is definitely the gaming tables.
Yeah.
I love all the weirdness that's going on. I love the, like, they had this strange Star Trek game, which I don't think we even got pictures of it, right?
Aye.
But it was like, it was the bridge of the old Star Trek, yeah, like the original series.
Is this the
series.
Action figure scale one?
Yes.
It had figures this sort of size here.
Yeah, you want me to grab?
Yeah. So right. They had Star Trek figures.
Come here, like, we're about this size.
This sort of size.
So absolutely huge.
Wandering around on the ship, and lizardy creatures with yeah. funky guns shooting at them and stuff. And screens to say if the shields are up and stuff like that. And I have no idea how it worked, but I was just mesmerized by it. Just like, it's weird.
You couldn't not look at it.
And the yeah. volcano, I got excited about that.
Oh yeah, there was a table with a light up volcano.
Yeah.
Oh, that was so cool.
Yeah. And the minion stuff, I got kind of excited about that.
Those are cute.
What did you get excited about for the minions? Be honest.
Probably my favorite
Be
thing.
Be honest.
Probably my favorite thing of Salut is the minion fart gun.
Yes, you had just a little bit of fun with that, just teeny bit.
Just a tiny bit.
Well, actually, that reminds me, Lance this week actually put out an outtakes reel of you using it,
yeah,
and us at Salute in general, which is on backstage. So, guys, if you want to check it out, come across thebeastofwar.com because it is absolutely hilarious.
But the thing about the minion, we're losing Ben, we're having crap connection issues, but I'm going to press on. The thing about the minion fart gun, right? He's like, I zeroed on it straight away because I was trying to get one for Christmas.
Were you really?
I was dropping all the hints. Every time I was in Tesco, look at this, Anna. Look at this, Anna. How cool is that? And I thought the hints hadn't sunk in. And then I got back.
I'm quite sure that that was
like,
Anna.
That minion fork on that you dropped so many hints about getting for Christmas. And I say, like, you did get the hints. You just didn't get me the gun.
No, I'm sure she totally got them.
She got
and just made an executive decision with no.
I do not want to live
no.
with this.
No.
How about no?
Yeah, so to wrap up, Ben's loved the gaming tables. Dawn's loved the artwork and stuff like that. Warren's got some really cool minis.
I love the community members.
Justin liked getting people drunk.
What? Fun!
I think we're going to talk a bit more about Salute in the backstage. We're gonna, and we're going to go for a break, and then we're going to be back to talk about some Kickstarters.
In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your MegaCon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastofwar.com. Venture into the dangerous dungeons of Myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastofwar.com and begin your story.
All right, welcome back. We're going to talk about some Kickstarters. First up, one that's dear to my heart, a Ghostbusters board
right?
game.
Another book.
So it's
Another.
Ghostbusters 2,
yes.
The board game.
Yes.
Is now on Kickstarter.
It is.
Now, there was originally Ghostbusters, the board game.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Now we're back for Uno 2-0.
Yes, number two, based on the second movie.
Is
yes.
it Uno actually two?
No,
that's
Uno.
One.
One. Uno. Do it.
Okay, Duo 2.
Say it is, but it's not. Yeah.
Ben, let's go to you first. Let's see where the Kickstarter is and stuff at the minute.
Yeah, so this is the Ghostbusters 2 board game. It's based on the second movie, which is all about Viggo the Carpathian, so the creepy painting that you saw in the second movie.
Oh,
and this is their
Justin's just saying he loves the artwork.
Right, okay, yes, but yes, anyway, this was a cool little standalone expansion, I guess you'd say, for the Ghostbusters game. So you can play this by itself, and it has some really cool cooperative elements in there for the four players. One of the really cool things about this, and something that we're seeing more of, actually, in board games at the moment, is that it can be played solo. All four characters have to be involved at the same time in the game, but you can play it by yourself if you want to do as well. And this is some really good stuff. It's got some really cool abilities in there and stuff like that. Nice scenarios and stuff. And an RPG-ish design to it as well, which is really cool. So yeah, you can paint all the different scenarios, catching ghosts and busting them and stuff like that. Really cool.
Now, Dawn, I'm not the only one excited about this. You're excited about this because
yes.
you actually got to talk to the creators of the game.
Yes, last year at Gen Con, we got to speak to the creator of the game. And it was just, it's always fun to hear the insight from the people that have, you know, made it go from word one. So, you know, with the ability for them to combine both movie property and comic property and cartoon property, there's just so many different places to go with it. And
how
so
is that different from the first board game? Was the first board game based on all those different sort of IPs melded together as well?
It is, yeah. It probably more on the cartoon aspect of it. But with this one, they were able to tie in a little bit more of the movie elements to it. So, you know, Viggo Your Lady Liberty is actually a model that is going to get to come in and walk across the board. I mean, it's just all the things that you've come to know.
So
and
when
love.
You say movie elements, Ghostbusters 2 movie
yes.
elements.
Yes, correct. Yeah, it's
like,
following
like the Slimer guns. And
yes,
things.
This game actually, you know, in the original game, everybody, you know, they have their proton, you know, beams to catch the ghosts with. You'll still get to do that in this next game, but you'll also have mood slime. Entering this, you know, so there's going to be different ways that you're going to have to deal with ghosts in it. Some of them will still, yes, mood slime Justin.
This was sort of where I dropped into the Ghostbusters universe. I actually missed Ghostbusters 1.
What?
And
Justin.
The first one I watched was actually 2.
Don't even go.
I was a kid.
Oh my gosh.
Don't even start.
I was a kid.
Don't even start, Dawn. You'll be here
it's
all night.
Ghostbusters, Justin.
Of course I know.
You'll be here all night if you start asking what 80s movies you haven't seen.
Hang on. I was born in 86.
Go back and watch them.
I have done.
You missed the best decade of movies, man.
Right?
Okay, list below. What
yeah.
am I missing?
Yeah,
what should
so,
I watch?
But yeah, so this game will combine the elements of using the proton beams as well as mood slime.
Yes.
And some of the ghosts, you'll have to do both elements to. Some will be one or the other. So it introduces some different elements to it.
Like Viggo himself, who
correct.
Needed to be slimed and protons.
Yes, because, you know, first you had to tone him down a bit, and then you had to catch him and throw him in a trap. So,
Well,
yeah,
the minis for this are looking really, really cool.
They've gone with a little bit different direction with the characters this time. So you've got two options. They've got their courtroom outfits on. That's the angle because we're in the second movie property. And then the figures behind them have mood slime packs.
Nice.
So.
And then of course Viggo himself.
Yes.
Do they have the two ghosts from the courtroom? Do you know the way they're the brothers?
Oh,
who
I
got,
do,
who
and
got
I
sent
don't
down by the judge.
Remember.
Let me see if I can actually find them here.
Because that would be cool.
That would be cool.
Because that's bam right open. That's the opening of the movie.
I'm just going to scroll
quickly. Do you know if they have
right
the Ghostbusters, the ghosts from the opening scene in Ghostbusters 2?
I'm not sure if they do.
I don't think they are. I really don't think they are, but...
Well, that's weird.
Because I did see a picture up here, I think, of all of the ghosts. Ah, here we go.
Yeah.
Do you see anyone you recognize, Lloyd?
Not
is
from
it
those
these two guys?
Two.
I kind of thought it was them.
Is it?
These two
so
guys
the two
on
blue
the
guys
side.
That we're seeing here.
If I can't, I'm trying now to
I know.
Through my mind to try and remember.
I don't remember names at all. So,
someone in the comments below will know the answer.
Let us know.
Both
yes.
Below.
Yes.
What's the tiers and stuff, rewards and stuff like for in this Kickstarter?
Rewards. I'm not exactly sure. I haven't seen them yet.
Ben,
I've been scrolling through.
One of the interesting things for this is that they've got obviously a lot of ability to pick up the main game and the one from before, so the Ghostbusters 1 game. But they've also got some really high tier rewards as well, which allow you to actually create both a ghost and a Ghostbuster of yourself if you pledge the right amount of money.
Ooh, that'd be
so this
super
means,
cool.
Yeah, this is really cool. So you get them made in art form, so a really nice drawing, but you can also get 3D print files for the ghost at that level, and also a miniature made in resin of yourself as a Ghostbuster with a real story done by one of the comic book writers as well. So that's really, really awesome.
Lloyd, you could realize your dream of being a Ghostbuster.
Oh, I could be a Ghostbuster.
You could, yeah.
This is why I'm kind of jealous of the creators of this, because the actual video for this, they have Winston from the original movies in the actual video with them, which I just think is one of those really cool things, because who doesn't want to work with one of their childhood idols?
Right.
Let's be honest. Lots of kids would have looked at that and just went, oh my God, that's so cool. So I'm sure there's a small child inside each of the creators just going, I'm actually doing this. It's amazing.
So one of my favorite things about this game and about the original Ghostbusters game is that it is scenario driven. You can play it straight out of the box. You can pick a single scenario to play, but it's campaign based. So it's almost RPG-ish, that's what Ben had mentioned before, in that. However, when your game ends, when you're going to go move on to another scenario, you keep your character cards at the level that they were with what you accomplished throughout the game, and then you start at that level into the next game. So every time your Ghostbusters gain experience points, they level up, get extra abilities opened up to them, which creates more variety of different gameplay things that can go on in a scenario.
Nice.
And then in this second game, there's goo piles that are added to the mix, which just creates almost a mini game. aspect to what's going on in the game, because
what's a goo pile?
It's literally going to be designated as a pile on the board, and your Ghostbusters will have to investigate it. Mm. So in addition to your primary objectives in either of these games are to clear the board of all the ghosts and close the gates, because the ghosts will continue coming into the board through the gates from the spirit world. So you will have to still do those, but you'll have to explore the goo piles, and who knows what you'll find in there. So it'll be cool equipment, things that you can add, buff your Ghostbusters, different things like that, or bad things can happen.
A minion fart gun.
I don't know that you're going to find a minion fart gun in there.
Digging through mood slime in this game, okay.
There's a crossover, Ghostbusters meet minions.
Cryptozoic, maybe you want to talk to Lloyd about adding a minion fart gun to the game. I don't know.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's a lot of fun. Yeah.
So you know this because you have played it? Or
yes. We picked up the base game after Gen Con last year and have been playing that since, and it's a lot of fun. And then through conversations with Cryptozoic, we actually had the ability to get a hold of pre-Kickstarter pieces for the second game. So we've gotten to play, you know, with mock-up elements. I know, lucky. Right? Yes. And it is very cool. The new elements that they've added, the game really brings something different to it. And because, as Ben mentioned, it's a standalone expansion, you can play it straight out of the box, and or you can combine components with your original game if that's how you want to play it.
Oh, that's cool. What
it
sort of components
cool.
can you combine? Can you combine like board pieces and stuff?
I'm thinking your tiles and things you can mix and match with, and then there's not goo piles in the first one, but you could, you know, move that component over into that, as well as if you like the looks of your miniatures from the first game, you can use them in place of your miniatures from the new game. There's just a lot of stylistic changes that you can do within there.
Cool.
So, what's it like to play the game? Do you have to move around the board a lot? Do you move as a group? Do you move individually?
You move totally individually. It is a cooperative game in that ultimately your goal is going to be to clear all the ghosts and close the gates. And you do have to work together as a team. But things that you accomplish along the way will cause your Ghostbuster to level up. The element that I really like about it being cooperative is that one hit with a proton stream is not ever going to be enough to take out a ghost. It'll take a number of them. So each one of your Ghostbusters has different colored rings that represent your proton stream.
Yeah.
So if it takes three of you have to be in line of sight of the ghost, and you'll put one of your rings on it for each one. And for every ring that you have for representing a proton stream on the ghost when you go to put it away, you will gain that experience point. It doesn't matter that you're, you know, if you're the last one that actually physically puts the ghost away, everybody that was involved in putting that ghost away still gets the experience points from it.
I see.
And
so
what's the
reason for it?
What's your sense of jeopardy, as in, you know, we put the ghosts away.
Right.
But what happens to Ghostbusters? I mean, do we get slime?
Yes, you absolutely get slime.
Do we lose
slime.
Abilities? What, yeah. What's the
knockback?
Yeah, or knockback.
Yes, you absolutely can get slimed, and you can get physically removed if it gets to beyond a point that you can't do anything with it.
Removed as in go back to the Ghostbusters house?
Yes, you're out, as in you're no longer
so
in the game.
Run away!
But what if there's three, four of you,
mm-hmm.
and like it takes at least three of you to catch a ghost?
Yes.
So you've lost one.
Yes.
So you're down to three.
Yes.
That's the point where you're like, we can't lose another person here, otherwise we won't be able to achieve
Correct.
These objectives.
And this is the cool part about it. So say you get slimed. And the way you get slimed in this game is anytime a ghost is going to move through you, you're going to get slimed. This can happen on a straightforward ghost movement, or when you say, I'm going to shoot at this ghost, and you hit the ghost, or you miss, the ghost gets to roll dice, and it'll say, there's a movement square, a template that you put down, and it says the ghost is going to move two squares in X random direction. So you roll your die, and if it's a six, it moves in that direction. And if it happens to move towards you, you get slimed. Every time you get slimed, you lose an action point for the turn.
Yeah.
And so you have to try to get the slime removed from you so you can get back up to it. You always have an option of removing slime from yourself, but like in any other game, if you have to resort to doing that, that's your turn. Mm. You essentially are giving up anything else that you might be able to do. Where if Justin, if you could say, I'm going to use one of my action points to remove slime from you, then when it comes to my turn again, I have my full action points available to you.
And so
that's how you take care of, that's how you do your resource management to make sure that somebody is available to get another proton stream on a ghost. Mm.
So cool. the bad guys, the ghosts, run themselves?
Yes, essentially.
There's no game master such. It's four people versus the board.
Right.
Cool. Ben, what do you think?
Yeah, I think this sounds like really good fun. I'd be really interested to give this a go. I really like cooperative games like this, and I love the idea that they all have to work together. They can't sort of cooperatively go off and defeat all the ghosts by themselves. They have to sort of gang up and fight these guys. Yeah, I think it's really, really awesome. Yeah. Well, I want to give this one a go.
I do like the idea that one of our players in our gaming group can't just go Leroy Jenkins and bugger off down the board.
So Warren.
Why, whoever do you mean? Yeah, yeah.
Whoever. Yeah, I like that too. Awesome, awesome stuff. Funded to the max.
Oh, crazy already. Yeah. Yep.
Loads and loads of ghost options. I really like that idea of making a 3D printed version of yourself as a Ghostbuster.
Yeah.
And I think you should still have about 16-ish days on this.
Yeah.
So you do have time to get in and check it out.
There you go, if it tickles your fancy. Right, moving on. We've got another really cool Kickstarter to look at. Rum and Bones, Second Tide.
I love this game.
Why is it called Second Tide, Justin?
It's actually the second edition of the rule set. So we've seen Rum and Bones before. It's a MOBA-style game. So if you ever played something like Dota, League of Legends, things like that, it's sort of a tower defense game where you have your mobs running up three lanes on a board, right? They've actually transferred this into a board game variant where it's pirates on ships. So you'll have two ships. You'll have your characters who are the big guys who are meant to do everything heroic and make it so that your crew can defeat the other one. Because the two crews will just fight against each other quite happily until you bring in your heroes to turn the tide either way or the other.
Cool. Ben, I'm going to come... Oh, do you have more to say?
I do have more to say. Because while we had the guys from Cool Mini across, myself actually got to play a game of this with the creator of the game. This has been streamlined beautifully because the original game, there were a few mechanics in it which weren't great.
Yeah.
You know, they worked, but they weren't great. The thing with this is now that's been tidied up. So things like your ability management and stuff, instead of killing stuff and getting coins to activate abilities, you're now killing stuff and getting coins to level up abilities, which I really like the idea of. So it feels a lot more fast-paced.
Cool. Can we see where the Kickstarter currently stands?
Yes.
At the point of filming.
Ta-da!
So before we well come funded. Back to we have the interview recorded, Ben.
Yeah.
What do you think of Rum and Bones Second Tide?
I think this is a really cool idea. I really like the whole sort of MOBA onto the tabletop style of idea that we're going for now. A lot of other good board games are picking that up. These guys have given it a very original take on things, and it's awesome fantasy pirates. Can't really say much worse than that, can you? So, or much better than that, I guess you'd say.
You see, it's the design of some of the miniatures that are really, really cool in this. Because you have all your fantasy creatures, and then you see the way each of the miniatures is colored in this, Lloyd?
Yeah.
That denotes the character class.
Oh.
So you have a few different ones. So your big green guys are like your big tanks and stuff. Your white ones are your leader commander types. Yellow is swashbuckling, you know, DPS type guys.
Cool, cool stuff. Right, let's get into the interview. So yourself, you're in the interview with?
With John and I believe it's Mike from Cool Mini or Not who created the game.
Right,
so
let's see what they had to say.
Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty Jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com. Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastofwar.com.
Okay, everybody, I am joined in the studio by John and Michael Chenal from Cool Mini or Not to have a talk about Rum and Bones. So, for those of us who don't know this game, what exactly is it?
So, Rum Bones is a MOBA-inspired board game. And for those who don't know what that is, basically those are massive online battle arena style games. So you're going to be controlling a team of characters, duking it out against an opponent and their team of characters, trying to claim objectives, wreck their other ship over here, kill their heroes, and claim victory.
So it's pirates.
Yep. Yes.
Be happy, John. It's pirates. Come on. It's pirate ship battles. This is absolutely fantastic.
Yep.
So what are we seeing on the tabletop here then? Is this a core box, yeah?
This is the Rum Bones core box, the Wellsport Brotherhood versus the Bone Devils. Mm. They're just kind of set up to show like in mid-game action what you'd be seeing here.
Yeah, so we have all of our heroes in different colored plastics to actually show them, and our two crews in different colored plastics. So how does it actually play out? Say we were playing a turn.
So in the standard game of Rum and Bones, I've got three heroes deployed. My opponent would have three heroes deployed. Each of the heroes has different classes, and that's how they're color-coded to show their different strengths and weaknesses. Mm-hmm. So for example, the yellow guys here, these are swashbucklers. So they're your melee damage-dealing guys who just run up and, you know, just deal all tons of damage and kill heroes.
Mm-hmm.
You would have brutes, big tanky guys who actually get stronger the more damage they have on them.
Nice.
And each of these heroes is unique. they have their own unique powers. Mm-hmm. Each of them has a hero card right here. Mm-hmm. Let's tip that up a little bit here.
Yep.
Which would show all of their abilities that they can do. Each character has three unique abilities. Mm-hmm. Five characters per side in the core box.
Okay, so it really does have that MOBA feel. These are my heroes. They're going to turn the tide in this battle.
Yep. You know. And all the other little miniatures you see here, they're faction color-coded. And these are your deckhands and your bosuns. These are mm-hmm. your background characters in any of those pirate movies you see that are just mm-hmm. you know, constantly fighting in the back and never really getting anywhere until a hero comes in and just you know kills 10 of them. And so that's how... though you're not going to have a lot of control over these guys here. They're just kind of pushing forward and... you know, trying to wreck stuff in the background.
Yeah, again, it's that classic MOBA style, just seeing the wave after wave of minions. Mm-hmm. What do you think, John?
It's exactly that. It has that MOBA feel to it, for sure. Now, I haven't played a lot of them, because I break computers when I do.
Yeah, I remember times way back whenever there was screaming, shouting, and threats of murder.
Well, that's one of the benefits. No keyboard or anything, so you can't break any big expensive computer parts. And they're all hard plastic, so if you do rage out and throw them around, they're quite durable.
Good. That's it sold for me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, I actually did get to play through a game, but I don't think it was actually this set I was playing with, was it?
No, it wasn't. So we have our upcoming Kickstarter for our second core box. And one of the things that we are very excited about is we've actually gone and revamped some of the mechanics in the game. Mm-hmm. We've listened to fan feedback over the last year and a half that the game's been out, and we've made some changes that we really feel enhance the play style and just the experience of the game. Now, the biggest one is going to be, I showed you earlier, you have your hero cards here, mm-hmm. and these have your abilities. Well, one of the things that we've changed is each hero, and keep in mind these are early prototypes, so,
okay, so
printed paper here.
This is alpha?
Yes, very alpha.
Okay, so this if we get a little further down into shop.
This is a new hero dashboard for Captain Daniel Pale. Mm. Now, as you'll notice, the abilities aren't printed on here. That's because they come on little ability cards that you have here.
Ah, I see.
And what we've done here is actually introduced a leveling mechanic. So in the old game, you would get coins from killing heroes and killing deckhands and bosuns, and you just use those to power up your abilities and use them, kind of like an energy meter from like a fighting game.
I see. So I had to spend the coins to pull off my massive, glorious, amazing attack. Yeah,
exactly. What we've done now is that the coins are used to actually buy and, more importantly, level up abilities. Mm-hmm. So, for example, Daniel Pale here, he's going to start with just his little basic attack, his Quicksilver Blade. Four coins here, and keep in mind, all these numbers and variables could change at this point.
Yeah, this is alpha.
Yes. Four coins, he can actually level that ability up, it gets stronger, or actually start buying his other abilities here, unlocking them, leveling them up as the game goes on as well. So there's a real sense of progression mm-hmm. with your characters as you're playing through the game.
Yeah, I like that.
It feels more like a bit of a role-playing element to it. You know, he's not just getting a bit of reputation and spending that to do something epic, mm-hmm. he's working for his epicness, and he's keeping mm-hmm. that.
It's a form of experience. You know, he's gaining new abilities, he's getting stronger, and you're mm-hmm. keeping those upgrades as the game goes on. So the longer the game goes, the more powerful your guys are going to get, the more abilities they're going to unlock.
Yeah, I do like that idea because it upscales the battle as you go. So suddenly the fight that was across the deck has suddenly become so much more fierce, so much more aggressive.
Yeah. One other thing that we've done is we've revamped the turn order in the game.
Okay.
So in the standard core game of Roman Bones, I'm going to activate all my heroes, my deckhands and bosuns, and you're going to activate all your heroes and bosuns. We've listened to fan feedback over the last year, and we've incorporated in an alternating activation method. So I'll take my turn. I would activate one of my heroes, like Captain Pale right here. He would swing across over here and start killing your deckhands, getting coins, leveling up.
Well, what did you just do there?
Oh, I swung across here. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, there's a gangplank here, which is kind of blocked, but you just jumped across the wharf. What happened?
That is one of my favorite features in the game, is that this is a pirate movie. I mean, swinging across, if we didn't include that, then we would have failed in our mission entirely.
Okay, fine.
So one of the things you can do is do riggings across the ship, and there's risks to do that. You could rig, you know, massive and cover massive distances, landing unexpected places, but you also run the risk of falling in the water.
Oh,
so it's a risk versus reward system.
Still, it gives you nice cinematic moments. Very nice.
Absolutely. And so we've taken that. Most of the core mechanics have stayed the same. The really other big change is that alternating activation method. So once I pay my captain here, does all his cool stuff over here, he's done. You're going to have a chance to respond with one of your heroes. And we're going to go back and forth until everything's done, and everything's going to reset. So instead of, I'm going to take all my turn, go and push forward, and then you're going to take your turn and go back, this allows for much more dynamic things to happen, because it becomes a strategic option of, what am I going to activate? What is he going to do? And now how is my opponent going to react to that?
Yeah, you see, that's one thing I'd say. Whenever it's all of one side going, it just feels like Titanic smacks in the face against each other. Whereas, yeah, this, it's a lot more cinematic. You're getting in going, okay, I was going to activate him, but he's ran up that damn brute. Now I have to get my swashbuckler in and actually try and stab him to death.
Yep. Now, one other thing to cover on here is, as you see here, this is actually upgraded components from the core set of Rum and Bones.
Yes.
This is nothing new here, which will be a new full set with new crews, new pirates, new sculpts, and everything.
Oh, I see.
What we're going to be doing is having an actual upgrade kit, so you can take all the previous Rum and Bones stuff you had and upgrade it to this new version. Mm-hmm. And we're going to keep that we're going to basically almost be selling that at cost for people, because we want people to just be able to get it, you know, and just experience the new stuff and just jump right into it. You know, this is not going to be something that we're going to like, oh, you know.
Okay, so all of a sudden, this box doesn't become obsolete.
Exactly.
Okay,
I
like that idea.
You can buy one upgrade pack, upgrade every old product that you have bought in just one swift move, and now it's all fully compatible with everything moving forward.
Okay, that I really, really like. What do you think yourself, John?
Absolutely, because the last thing you want to do is have a game out for a year and then suddenly turn around to all your fans and go, nah, get rid of that. You want this one now instead.
No, that's never something we could, you know, do. So we're going to take care of, you know, all the fans and the supporters from Bones that have been, you know, backing us and giving us all this feedback this last year. The ones who we're doing all this for, the ones who have been saying, I like the game, but there's some changes that I think could be made better. So we listen to that, and that's why we're doing a lot of these changes.
Okay. I think this sounds absolutely brilliant. Guys, this is going to be one to watch out for. I assume the Kickstarter will be coming out soon.
Oh, yes.
So keep an eye on Kickstarter and keep an eye on the Weekender, because as soon as it comes out, we'll give you a shout and let you know that it's live and you can jump in on it. So I think we're done here. I think we'll move back to the main show. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure having you on the show.
Progress comes to a world of magic as science and the arcane combine to make marvels. Meet steampunk inventors and orc mystics at the Volsung Hub on beastsofwar.com. From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastsofwar.com.
Cool, awesome stuff. It's great to see Mike giving us a real grind in the game there. Justin, what extra do you want to say about it? I mean,
well, there's one thing that really jumped out at me that's really, really important. Anybody who already owns Rum and Bones isn't getting done over by this new Kickstarter, because they're doing an upgrade pack. Now, I like the idea that my old game is not becoming obsolete. I can just go out, quickly grab an upgrade pack, and I'm up and running again. Because that's something that would worry me whenever someone brings out a new generation of rules, is my old stuff becoming obsolete.
That is interesting. So what's these upgrade packs? Is there pictures or what?
I don't know if I have pictures or anything yet. I'll have a little scout about. If I can find anything, I will show them off, obviously. But no, it's that idea that they're taking that little bit of extra care of the people that have already jumped in on the game, which really, really seems nice to me. It's also just the gameplay of it really appeals to my gaming senses, because I used to love playing Dota and stuff like that.
Okay, and when the interview was filmed, the Kickstarter wasn't up at the time.
No, the Kickstarter wasn't.
Do we need to go back to Kickstarter pages? Is there anything else that we want to specifically
show? There's a few other things they're doing on Kickstarter, so I'll bring it up on the screen here, because Ben, you've been researching some of this. So we've got the Inquisition Calls, Reinforcements, and Dice. So what is this?
Yeah, so these are some optional hero packs you can buy, a little bit like you would in any MOBA. You can pick up new heroes and stuff like that. These are teams of heroes, and they've done three of them so far that are optional to sort of pick up and add to your pledge. The first one, as you say, is the Iron Inquisition, and these guys are sort of the hunters of pirates and miscreants. They have fire and brimstone and big guns and stuff like that. We also have some really cool guys on one of the other pages, which are the Tusketeers, and these are orc musketeers.
Well, let's start. We're looking at the Kraken at the minute.
Yes, yeah. So this is on the same page as the Iron Inquisition down from there, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, these are the Tusketeers here. Oh, yes. My God, these are cute.
These guys are orc musketeers who are led by Milady de Winter, who anyone who's familiar with the musketeers and stuff like that.
Not Lady de Winter.
Yes, Lady de Winter, yeah. So if you know the TV series, you'll know who she is and stuff, yeah.
I like the way they've actually changed the faction, because you remember the last one we looked at, Lloyd? You had all the different character classes in it. Whenever we look at this particular one, we're seeing we've got lots of DPS, big tank, and then our orange character. I don't know what class that is yet. But
no, I'm not sure, but yeah.
It's nice to see that they're doing different stuff with different factions in this.
Who are we wondering about? The orange character?
Yes, the orange character, I don't
Devious.
Know. Devious.
That's what she is.
I'm guessing some kind of mastermind character, which would be very fun to play on the tabletop.
She is a bit. She comes back from life.
Yeah.
Back from life, back from the dead. Through life.
Are we
she enjoyed life
moment?
So much, she did it again. Yes.
And then, who are our last ones, Ben?
My favorite ones, these ones, are the fairy tale heroes. And this is the Three Little Pigs,
oh,
Red Riding
goodness.
Hood, and the Big Bad Wolf.
That's cool.
And I think these are fantastic. Yeah.
Mm. They really are really characterful.
That's quite badass. I love the look of Big B.
Right?
Big B looks really, really cool.
Big B is awesome, yeah.
Oh, very, very nice. Very cool stuff, Ben.
So what? So they're what? Expansion packs? What are those?
Additional crews, essentially.
Additional mercenary crews,
if I'm correct. So in the game, everybody plays a pirate crew to begin with, right? So you've got your base set where you've got your heroes versus your undead. You've then got additional ones which add an Asian-flavored force and a French-flavored force.
Yeah.
So being able to add in new characters to the game is really going to change up how it plays, because it is your heroes in this game that make the difference between victory and defeat.
Okay, awesome stuff. Right, I'm going to press this on because I need to squeeze in one more Kickstarter just before we round off the show. We had the guys from Paranoid Miniatures on the show a couple of weeks back talking about Mythos. Their Kickstarter is now up and live
it
and
is.
Going. They launched it at the same weekend of
Absolute.
Which
I thought that was
maybe it's supposed to be smart an idea, but it salutes. you're gonna have to shout loud to be noticed at the same time as salute. But it's up. It's going.
You see, this might have been the clever thing, because with people coming to their stand on the day of salute, everybody that comes up to their stand, they go, "Oh yeah, by the way, we have a Kickstarter on the go right now. You should go check that out. Here's a card."
But it's worth highlighting because we've got a great interview with them.
Oh yeah, yeah,
about 40 minutes worth.
From 2 weeks back.
Yeah, so not this episode, but the last episode of the Weekender.
Yeah, yeah.
But now the Kickstarter's up. I want to have a quick browse around the page and see what it's up to. Don, you know a lot about this. We're really interested in this game.
Definitely. Yeah. No, we had such great chats with the guys. They're very passionate about the game, about the world. It's full of all kinds of wonderful story. You know, so if you like your Lovecraft stuff at all, you know, you'll absolutely love this. I mean, just come on, look at the bugs.
Yeah, the bugs. I was actually watching the Weekender last week where it was described what these are. These are actually tomb creatures that actually breed and eat each other until there's only one left that matures and then has more, and then it just cycles and cycles and cycles.
Ooh.
It's really, really creepy.
Creepy, super creepy.
And that's what you get with Lovecraftian stories. So moving on down, here are these.
Yeah, this is the free cultist model. So anybody that pledges at a box set pledge will get this free bad guy in the mix here. So, you know, cool. Again, keeping with your Lovecraftian goodness, you know, your cultist. Justin and I know you said you love the Priory.
Oh, yeah, the Priory. If I scroll down and see if I can actually find them here. Well,
there's
we've
the
got
sea
the
queen.
Sea Queen, who's just a gorgeous-looking miniature. We've then got 3D renders and stuff. And so this is the leader for the Priory, and I think the miniature for him is just so characterful.
He looks great.
Holding that balefire and the big-ass bayonet is really cool. We've then got this guy who is actually the big guy for the Priory set.
Why does he look like he's coming out of the ground?
Because he's a golem. He's a golem. A very traditional style golem that is actually made from clay. And because he was raised up with an Egyptian tomb, this is what Warren was hearing and saying.
Ben, I hear you getting excited about this.
Yeah, I really like the whole Egyptian thing they've gone for. I love the idea of like the mummy and sort of opening up these tombs and finding these strange creatures inside them. Yeah, I really like this big guy. He's awesome. Yeah.
There's what the Priory looks like. Tell me they do not look like a really cool adventuring band.
So they look like they mean business.
These guys work together. They're all so different.
Yeah, they're that sort of, you know, turn of the century adventurers club coming in from all walks of life.
So the golem's actually a hero.
He was raised up in ancient Egypt, and because there was, I think, the ashes of one of the temple guard left over, that's why he's actually got all of the Egyptian garb and stuff on him, which is really cool. You've then got the next guy along who's a pilot who got taken down and unfortunately no longer believes in the use of weaponry, so he now uses a flamethrower.
Yep. Well, and then Lloyd, like you said about them looking like they're quite different, you know, like how do these fit together? They built the story in such a manner that your scenarios can actually have, you know, if you're going to play it like from scratch, your characters can bump into each other throughout the games and start linking up to play along. So in your mind, it can really solidify how you've got this kind of mix-match group of characters
really
together.
Stories with it, which I really like the idea of.
and again, it's Shane Cook working on this.
Yes, yes.
The guy who did the awesome artwork that we just had a look at earlier in the show.
Yeah, they give him an idea. I had a really great chat with the guys on Backstager meetup night, and it was just something to listen to them. And Mark would say, I'll come up with an idea about a character, and we'll just say, okay, I want a sand golem. Go and give it to Shane, and then he just goes crazy with drawings, and that's where you end up. So
I'm very tempted by this. Very, very tempted by this, I won't lie. So, do you want to scroll on down the page a little bit, Lloyd, see what else we have here?
Okay.
So we have this, which is, so this is the different levels you can pledge in at. So I like the idea. I think I would possibly go for one or two in the pledge to actually, go for it. What do you think, Lloyd? Would you be tempted by this?
I'm tempted by the starter pledge because I'd like to see how the minis and all progress because I think they're going to be amazing.
They are. They really are. They're coming together just beautifully.
But I would start with I would start obviously with the starter. Get stuck into the world. See what it's like, and then I probably would just buy a load more after that because it's the sort of game where you're going to keep adding to it because every time you add something to it, the stories evolve.
It does. It absolutely does.
Yeah. You've then also got your stretch goals coming up as well. You've got Dorothy Good, Blood.
Yeah, the Wildborn.
Yeah. This is another faction on top of that, and then you've got all your add-ons and stuff. So if you want to actually just pick up single miniatures from other factions to work on, you can do that as well, which I think is a really cool idea.
I like the single minis idea. That's kind of cool because I was looking at some of them thinking, oh, particularly
like that.
So I like the idea of being able to zero in on that one miniature and bring it into the game and add it to the storyline. Right, if that's tickled your fancy, like I said in the last episode, we'll get a link in the description. There's an epic interview with the guys from Paranoid Miniatures. And I did get a chat with them about the game and stuff as well after it, and it does sound like such an amazingly fun game to play.
Currently, I think it's about 22-ish days left on it.
Yeah.
Whenever people are going to be watching this. So you do have time to go and check it out.
Okay.
Have a look.
And with that, it wraps up the show. Here, you're pointing at me. Pointing at me.
Because you forgot something.
I haven't forgotten anything.
Okay.
He was saving the best for last.
I'm up to it. Okay, go ahead. Like I said earlier, we're going to talk about Salute a little bit more in Backstage. But for you Backstagers, we also have a Salute swag bag that you can comment to win. So come on over to the XLBS show tomorrow. You'll see what's in the bag. Drop your comment in, and you'll be in with your chance to win an awesome Salute swag bag.
Full of excellent goodies.
It is full of some cool things. So, if you don't know what the XLBS show is, it's like a whole nother episode of this show. It's not an extended version, as much as it kind of portrayed like that at times. It's a whole new episode all in itself, another hour's worth of miniature talk. It's a great way to pass the weekend. You've got the front stage show on the Saturday. The backstage show on the Sunday, my voice is killing me today. Well,
on the Sunday, you can wake up, the sun is shining, the birds are chirping, you can get your iPad, and you can just watch it in bed while you wait for a bit of breakfast. Perfect way to start a Sunday morning.
And jammy dance.
And jammy dance if you're a winner.
Yeah, of course.
Or get into trouble if you told Justin secrets.
Oh,
okay.
Are we doing this before we finish?
No, it's backstage only.
Okay, Justin, come join us tomorrow if you want to find out a little bit more about that.
Justin loves to divulge secrets.
It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastsofwar.com.